making it live.
Nowadays, now it's recording all automatically connect to cloud. I don't know why.
Yeah, it was automated.
Dr. Shamsul, you can start.
Yes, I'll start. Very good evening from Authority of our side. Welcome to online education webinars. We would like to thank you, all our faculty, for sharing their knowledge and expertise with speciality in challenging times. We wish all our audience a healthy and safe days ahead, and we hope these webinars add value to your time. These webinars are dependent on internet speed. It might be at times unstable. Please bear with us for any issues with the internet. Today, we are going to have a DOA peer webinar on procedures. Now, I hand over to my developer to start.
Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all for Delhi Orthopedic Association and Pediatric Orthopedic Foundation third e-symposium. Please mute yourself, everyone. Yeah, I welcome you all for Delhi Orthopedic Association and Pediatric Orthopedic Foundation third e-symposium. We already had two symposiums, one on the upper limb and lower limb fractures, and this is the third in series. They're very important for postgraduates. This is on elective pediatric orthopedics. So all cases which there are four topics and all are important for exams. So today we have four speakers, Dr. Sanjay Swarup, Dr. Anil Agarwar, Dr. Alok Sood, Dr. Vikas Gupta. And we have a very power-packed Pediatric Orthopedic Association panel, and Dr. Manoj Padman, Dr. Ramni Narasimhan, Dr. Arun Goyal, Dr. P.N. Gupta, Dr. Kapil Gangwal. Also, I welcome from Delhi Orthopedic Association, Dr. Sharad Agarwal, President of Delhi Orthopedic Association, Dr. Lalit Maini, he is the President-elect, Dr. Harmesh Kapoor, Vice President, Hitesh Lal, Secretary, Dhananjay Gupta is Past President, Dr. Vineet Arora, he is a Scientific Committee Coordinator, and Dr. Yanul Haq. And also I will thank Ortho TV, especially Dr. Ashok Sham and Dr. Shamsul Huda, and also Dr. Ravi Chauhan to provide us this technical support. Now I request Dr. Manoj Pajman to introduce the faculty. Dr. Manoj.
Good evening, everyone. This has been a series of collaborations with which the Pediatric Orthopedic Foundation has been having with the DOA. I thank Dr. Sharad Agarwal and his team to kind of allowing us this to be part of this format, and Dr. Manish Dhawan, Praveen Chauhan, and his team, Shamsul Podat, for hosting this. Today we have an excellent faculty. We'll be looking at elective pediatric orthopedics. So from a very kind of broad generalist perspective, so we're going to be talking about post-septic sequelae, DDH, slipped capital femoral epiphysis, and Perthes. All of these topics are fairly comprehensive and it can take up the entire time of a webinar. So we have tried to kind of distill enough information from a practical management perspective. So apart from the faculty comprising the DOA, from the POF side, we have Anil Agarwal, Dr. Sanjay Swarup, Alok Sood, and Dr. Vikas Gupta as the speakers. And from panelists, we are privileged to have P.N. Gupta from Chandigarh and Kapil Gangwal from Jaipur for joining us. And additional panelists will be Professor Goel, myself, and Ramani. The talk, we'll start off with the talks, the brief talks, during which time, if there are any questions, please send them to WhatsApp to Dr. Manish Dhawan, and post-talks, we'll discuss it. Off to the first talk, which is Anil Agarwal from Tata Nehru.
Anil sir, in this way it will be difficult to share actually. First minimize the Zoom and then open it. Anil sir, am I audible to you?
Dr. Anil, can you hear us?
Anil, sir, am I audible? He's muted, actually.
Yeah. Okay.
Please first minimize the Zoom and then open it.
Okay. Minimize the Zoom and then open it.
PPT and then maximize the Zoom and then share the screen. The way you did it before, no?
Like. Okay. And now, is it visible?
The share screen. On the lower side panel, green button.
Share screen button on the Zoom, sir.
Is it okay?
Yeah, it's coming. Now it's okay, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Okay. Please. Okay, so we start with the first topic, the postseptic sequelae of the hip. I have kept it simple for the postgraduate. Okay. Moving. Okay. So the learning points will be the natural history and the interventions which we like to do in the septic sequelae hip. Before we plan anything, we must understand two basic concepts in this. First is the containment, and second is the capital head and femoral shaft communication. And we must also be aware of the classifications of the sequelae, which are most commonly Hunka and Choi. Okay, so a brief of Choi. There are four types, each divided into A and B, depending upon the increasing severity. Okay. So basically, when we go to the septic sequelae of hip, there are two varieties. One is the stable variety and the other is the unstable variety. The stable varieties are 1A, 1B, 2A, 2B and the 3A. In these cases, you will require proximal femoral procedures or acetabular augmentation. The second category is the unstable variety, which consists of 3B, 4A and 4B. Okay, let's understand this with few cases. Okay, first example is Choi type 2B, and there is a coxa vara or coxa valga in this, but the hip is contained. You can see on this, you can see the containment is there and the head communication with the femur is there. Okay, so this child sustained septic arthritis of the hip left side at the age of 18 months, and you can see a well-developed coxa vara in this case. The child presented with 3 cm shortening and lurch. So intervention was required. So you determine the alignment and the version and plan your surgery accordingly. So in this particular case, a valgus osteotomy was done, and this is 6 weeks postoperative. So things are quite simple here. So for this particular case, you can see that the stable varieties can be serially observed and realignment or acetabular procedure are required. And limb length particularly needs correction. Let's go to another case. This is Choi type 2A. Again, it's a stable variety. So this particular child, girl child, sustained infection at 6 months, but this time it was a polyarticular case. And the right hip, you can appreciate, if someone can appreciate, it's dislocated. Both knees were also drained at the same sitting. So this is at 8 age years. The changes in the opposite hip have also appeared, and you can see a metaphyseal spike over here, but the hip was still stable. So this is the left knee, this is the right knee, left shoulder. So altogether a polyarticular involvement. So at this time, you can see we got internal external view. The hip was more stable in the internal rotation views. We also obtained planning. You can also do arthrography if you want to define better. So in this particular case, a subtrochanteric valgus derotation osteotomy and extension osteotomy of the right side knee was done. So this is 3 months post-operative, 6 months post-operative, 1 year. And this time you can see a happy child, the knee, right knee was straightened, and there was some limb length discrepancy. And this is how the child squat and sit cross-legged. This is 3 years post-operative, and this is 9 years post-operative. The child is now 17 years old. This is how she stands. The knee deformity has reappeared. She has difficulty in walking and she can barely walk. And this is how she can sit cross-legged. This is her scanogram. Okay, so you can see that over the time, acetabular dysplasia is present now, and the hip, left hip, which was seemingly okay initially, had now started dislocating. So there can be the take home messages, there can be polyarticular involvement, and because right hip was drained, left hip was not drained, so it was just observed. So you can see changes later in these, and the combined effect of all these together can be quite disabling. And sometimes when you just observe, serial changes, acetylar dysplasia or changes in the proximal femur can appear, which can be deterioration, which can lead to deterioration of function. Okay, let's move on to the unstable variety. These are 3B, 4A and 4B. Okay, you can see this, there is either problem of the containment or there is a dissociation of the head from the femur. Let's first take up the 4A group. Most common are these post-septic dislocation with variable injury to the femoral capital epiphysis. These are also grouped under Jory's group 3, which have defined them better. So let's take this case, this 1.2-year male, infantile infection, right side. Okay, if you we got an MRI before surgery, you can see a malformed head, and you can see the shape of the head. What was done? An anterior lateral approach was used. We did osteochondroplasty and a Salter to cover the head. And this is 3 months post-operative. What you can observe is that as soon as the head ossified, you can see changes in the opposite hip also. This is 4 years follow of the same child. The child can see comfortably cross-legged, and these are his X-rays. You can see changes on both the hips. Okay, so the message from this case is that there can be post-sepsis, there can be delayed visualization of the epiphysis. The effect of sepsis insult can be visible several years later, and good function can be expected even in the bad X-ray. So poor radiograph doesn't always mean bad results. They can be good results as well. Okay. Another case, post-septic dislocation. In this particular case, the post-septic diagnosis was made on the basis of involvement of other joints. So you must look for other joints when you are suspecting sepsis. Again, in this particular case, the epiphysis was small but dislocated. But when you go inside, intraoperatively, there was mismatch between the acetabulum in the head, and you have to use KYS to initially provide stability to the head. So open reduction in these cases is not always easy. This is 6 months post-operative. You can see changes appearing on the contralateral side also. And this is 2 years. This is 3 years. So the take-home message is that if you do intervention at the right time, it can alter the natural history. The dislocated hip is now stable. And also you must remember that the appearance of the epiphysis is somewhat delayed in cases of post-septic hips. Okay, now let's move to the unstable varieties, choroid type 3B, pseudoarthrosis. Here there is a dissociation between the head and the femur. So this particular case was drained at day 10 of the life, and you can see a dislocated hip on the left side. 2 months, further evidence of diaphyseal osteomyelitis appeared. 6 months, the osteomyelitis started healing, but we were not sure of the status of the head. Okay, so the status became clear only at 1 year of age, when you can see the pseudoarthrosis. This patient was serially observed for 1.5 years, 3 years, but you can appreciate is there is a worsening of the coxa vara in these cases. This is 4.5 years when the coxa vara was almost 90 degrees. We intervened in this particular case. A valgus osteotomy with 2 fibular grafts was done. And this is 2 months post-operative, 3 months post-operative, 6 months post-operative, 3 years post-operative, and this is 5 years post-operative. So you can see that treatment at right time has prevented further coxa vara, and this child can sit comfortably and sit cross-legged. So you can appreciate that concomitant septic arthritis and osteomyelitis is common in our children. The dissociative physis can be viable, and it continued to grow if you have appreciated in the X-rays. And there can be a worsening of coxa vara in these types 3B particularly cases, and you must watch for this if you are serially observing them. Now for the most frightened variety, the 4B, complete loss of head and neck. So to give you an example, this particular child had an infantile infection, presented at 7 years, significant lurch and shortening. So these were the radiograph at 7 years. So a pelvic support osteotomy was done, proximal osteotomy stabilization with plate, distal osteotomy with unilateral fixator, and a contralateral distal femoral epiphysiotomy. So you can appreciate this proximal osteotomy, distal osteotomy, and a lengthening device. But we also put a contralateral femoral epiphysiotomy in this case. So to show you the progress of the things, this is postoperative, this is 3 months, this is 5 months, this is 7 months, 14 months, 27 months, 33 months, 39 months, 5 months, 48 months. So what has changed over the time? So the medialization which we did initially has now remodeled. The lengthening has also remodeled. The knee are now at the same level. So changes occur over the time. If you do a pelvic osteotomy early in the age, you must have, you can see these changes that you might have to reduce this process. So the take home message is that interventions, although significantly alter the clinical function, there can be significant remodeling in these cases, and some cases might require repeat or additional procedures. Thank you.
Thank you. Nice presentation.
So if I can be allowed to share the screen, I'll just bring in some points for discussion. Excellent presentation, Anil.
Can, Padman, can I ask a question?
Yes, you may.
Dr. Anil, a really excellent presentation, a really frightening cases, and you have dealt them with them so well. My question is that in many of the cases you said, you showed us that there is a changes in the other hip also, and they were detected after a certain period. So do you mean that hip also got infected the same time it got infected the same time as the primary one was, or did something happen later on? Can you hear me, Dr.
Anil sir?
Anil, please, so that the question was to you from Dr. Sharad. I don't think he heard.
Anil sir?
Anil, are you there? I think Anil has, we'll bring him back.
Yeah, Anil, we'll take this question later on, no problem. We can move forward.
So Anil, are you there? Okay. So, it was an excellent presentation. So I'm going to just kind of get the panelists involved. So from a very practical perspective, there are so many of these classifications going around. And I would like to get Dr. P.N. Gupta's view as well as Dr. Remini's view regarding these complex classifications. You know, there is Choi, there is Johari, there is other classifications. What is it that you're looking at through these classifications? For someone who's like intimidated by four types, 4A, B, and different managements. Can you give some brief, can you distill the classification and say, what is it that you want to know when you look at a post-septic sequelae in a hip? P.N. Gupta.
Yeah, see, basically, if you see the Choi's and Hunka's classification, they are basically the same. There's not much difference except for the numbers, which one puts in one way and other puts it in another way. Now, what you are basically seeing is that how it has affected the proximal femoral growth, the capital femoral epiphysis, the physis, as well as the femoral neck. So basically, depending on the severity, the classification goes on increasing. That means in type 1, there is less sphere involvement. And as you go further down, there is more sphere involvement.
So the first thing that you want, if I can just kind of summarize that, first thing that you want to look at, what is the morphology of the proximal femur? Is that right?
Yeah.
In terms of the presence of head, absence of head, is there a deformity? So that's what you want to know.
Yes. Exactly. Yeah. So if there is a head present, and if there is a head present, what is the morphology of the proximal femur? And if there is a head absent. And okay. Fourth thing is if the head is dislocated out. Okay. So that is with Jory's classic patient. Yes, that is not described in choice.
So Dr. Ramani.
Yeah.
I can bring you in. So is there
good evening. So I absolutely agree with PN, because you see, we have to understand that there are a lot of classifications, but we need to adopt a classification which is simple to use, and how, you know, with that classification, whether it helps us to directs us towards a kind of management which increases the function of the child at the end of the management. And first of all, before I even begin, I think I must compliment Anil's paper. It was very nice, very difficult cases which he managed and showed very well. Now, as PN said, we are only interested in basically two things. One is whether the femoral ossification nucleus is present or not. And the second thing is whether the hip is dislocated. I mean, these are the basic things which will point towards the path which you have to take in order to salvage, either get the hip back to some kind of a normalcy or salvage the hip in the best possible way. So I agree with PN. I think Jory's classification to quite an extent makes sense.
So from what I can gather from the speaker as well as the two of you is that one is morphology, which is like a static evaluation. And you also want to see whether the hip is unstable or dislocated and things like that. These are the two factors that you would kind of, okay, broadly speaking. So that brings me to kind of ask the question then, what is your investigation? You would start off with an X-ray, but beyond that, if you want to evaluate, and I want Dr. Kapil Gangwal's and Sanjay Swarup's opinion on this, in terms of what would be your preferred investigations? Would you always want an MRI? Are there limitations to what you can interpret from an MRI? Do you want a dynamic evaluation? So Kapil Gangwal, if you could kind of give your thoughts on that.
Yeah, Manoj, I always do an arthrogram, and I prefer it in comparison to an MRI, because arthrogram, I think, is, like you said, more dynamic, and you can do a push-pull, you can try and reduce it, you can try and move it around to see how spherical or dented the femoral head is. So it gives me more information. For some reason, if the arthrogram is unsuccessful, which it is in some circumstances because there's so much of fibrosis there, secondary to the old infection, then of course the MRI is the fallback.
So you would put your arthrogram more there. Would you then stage the arthrogram to kind of plan out your treatment, or is it you've already decided what to do and then kind of do an arthrogram? Is that how you would do
it? It's always staged. For a septic hip subluxation or a dislocation, I would always stage it, because I don't know whether the head is present or not, whether it is deformed or not, whether it is, what's the shape. So depending on what it is, then you have a discussion with the family and then you plan, because it's a big procedure. So you have to explain what's going to happen, what is the prognosis and all that kind of stuff.
Sanjay, your thoughts on this? Do you think differently, or you concur with Kapil? How easy it is to interpret and do an arthrogram in a septic, post-septic sequelae? Sanjay? Sanjay Swarup?
Yeah, I'm here. So I don't have any tremendous experience with septic arthritis, but in my practice, I use an MRI pretty early on in the disease when the situation is acute, to know how much, whether the bone is involved, not involved, what is the highlighting in the acetabulum, what is happening in the femoral side. After that, with me, it's usually containment and wait and watch, because I really desperately need to know over a period of time, what is the growth potential? How much is left? How much of this hip is salvageable? And that information comes in your clinic only on an X-ray and clinical examination. You need to know whether it's stable, unstable, whether it is growing, not growing, whether it's going to varus, valgus, whether the CFE appears or not, or does it dissolve over a period of time? All those answers are routinely given by an X-ray, because by the time you decide to intervene,
So I'm going to put you on the spot, Sanjay, here. So you wanted an X-ray. Here is a 15-month-old.
Right.
Who has had childhood history of infection. And right. That's come to OPD with hips like these.
Right.
What are your thoughts?
Well, here in this case, I need to know if the CFE is present or not, which, yes, you do put me on a spot here. In case I want to treat it now, in conjunction with my clinical examination, I would certainly want an MRI to see if the CFE is there or not there. And I would want to see what is the shape of the acetabulum. Has it suffered severely in the aftermath of the septic arthritis? Definitely.
Great. Fine. Okay.
So Dr. Manoj, can I interrupt? Can we take a question from the audience?
Yes, please.
Somebody wants to ask that how to clinically diagnose DDH versus dislocated hip due to septic hip versus Tom Smith arthritis, apart from the history, any clinical signs?
P.N. Gupta, do you want to take that question? Or Vikas Gupta, differentiate between DDH and a septic dislocation.
Clinically.
Clinically, there could be some telltale signs suggestive of previous infection, like a scar or a healed sinus. And at times, it is difficult also if there is no clear-cut history. But normally, you don't see the acetabular dysplasia in DDS radiographically. Clinically, I think the only feature which can differentiate from a developmental disorder like DDS could be some scar or a local fibrosis. And radiographically, by the changes, which I think quite evident in a septic case like a dysplasia, altered proximal femoral morphology, absence of the femoral head. I think any other.
Alok Sood, would you want to add anything more to that if you are getting a situation wherein, if there is a clear history forthcoming about some infection, that's fine. But otherwise, is there any way clinically that you can say with certainty that this is DDH and this is septic without an X-ray?
It is very important to differentiate in between the two. Right. Number one, there will be history. Then number two, as Dr. Vikas has told, there will be a telltale sign.
Please speak loudly. You're not audible.
Yeah. A telltale sign. Hello. Am I audible?
Please speak a bit loudly.
Hello. Am I audible now?
Yeah, better.
Yeah. So it is very important to differentiate it between two. Now, number one is a telltale sign, like a scar or a healed sinus. Number two, when you examine these patients, you will feel that there is, since the joint is, you know, the cartilage has already been eroded, right? Now there is no cartilage. So when you will rotate these joints gently, you will hear a fine crepitus, right? Which is usually not present in a DDH. In DDH, there will be click of reduction and there will be click off when it comes out. But in these cases of septic arthritis, when you will rotate or when you will flex or extend the joint, there will be slight fine crepitus. Number two, when you will try to abduct this, you will usually see the adduction deformity more as compared to DDH. Number three, when you will measure the limb length, it will be, the limb length loss will be higher in a septic as compared to DDH. Now, agreed, all these signs are relative, but when they are seen in the background of history, they lead you to a good diagnosis.
Thanks, Alok. So coming back to this X-ray, which Sanjay correctly said that he wanted to kind of get MRI to see what the status is. Kapil Gangwal and Anil Agarwal, if you could kind of, would you kind of be satisfied with an MRI? Would you want to do other things? Because there is a clear reason why the child has been brought. There is an abnormal gait. Do you see signs of instability which make you want to investigate it further? Kapil?
Can I intervene here?
Let Kapil answer and then, yeah.
No, are you showing an X-ray or something which I'm missing?
Anybody not see it?
No, I can only see your face right now.
No, I think you can swap the screen. I think you have swapped the screen.
Swap the screen?
Swap the screen. There is a button on the right top.
Oh, button. Yeah. Sorry. My fault. Sorry.
Okay, so Manoj, my take on this X-ray is that I think there is a delayed ossification of the capital femoral epiphysis, which is obvious. I think the hip on the right side is looking a little lateralized, but I don't think the hips are dislocated. There has to be a capital femoral epiphysis. I'm sure it's going to be smaller. It might be deformed. I don't think arthrogram or MRI at this point in my practice is going to change anything. I'd probably just observe this child. I don't think I'm looking at any intervention at this point. So I would not really force this child to go in for an investigation. Definitely keep under observation. And maybe over time, depending on how the symptoms are progressing.
Did we lose the speaker? Kapil, did we lose him?
Yeah. Vikas, sir?
Yeah.
You can continue the discussion. Actually, Manoj sir is joining in a while. His video is interrupted from his side. So you can continue the discussion with questions.
Dr. Vikas,
yeah.
If this discussion is over, can I take questions now or after this discussion?
Sir, you can take the question, sir.
Vikas, we can have the audio. Yeah. We can have the questions from the audience now.
Yeah. One question is from Dr. Sharad Agarwal, and his question is, what is the role of ultrasound in evaluation of septic sequelae hip?
Let me ask Dr. Pian, what is your view about this?
See, in my opinion, ultrasound has absolutely no role in defining the shape of the femoral head. However, it can be used to see whether a femoral head is present or not. So that is the only role of ultrasound. But if you're doing a surgical planning for this, then I think it has no role.
I would like to add actually the role of CT scan if you are planning to reorient, because most of these cases have abnormal version as well as abnormal anatomy of the acetabulum. So getting a CT scan prior to operating these hips, especially which are dislocated, I think it's a good idea. Maybe Dr. Alok, what is your viewpoint?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes,
CT scan is theoretically a very good investigation for planning. CT scan, and now it has been followed by 3D reconstruction also. But as far as our clinical practice is concerned, we do not get CT scans done routinely. Usually a plain X-ray, push and pull views, abduction reduction views, views in rotation, different rotations, and an arthrogram. These will suffice to decide about what is to be done with the patient. Because of very high dose of radiation, we usually do not get a CT scan done. But yes, there are studies which get CT scan done, and on top of that, they're also getting a 3D reconstruction done also.
Yeah,
how much varus and how much valgus has to be added.
So that was my actually thought. Dr. Lalit is there? Dr. Lalit? Yeah, so now you are actually doing a lot of 3D reconstructions. But so how do you actually see these hips? Can we go for 3D reconstruction, which would help us in planning these hips in a better way?
Yes, definitely. The only thing is that you need to be careful that you need very thin slices. You need a 1mm cut to do a 3D printing because these children are small, and if the cuts are too large, you will lose specific details. And we do get a pretty okay image, even in a very small child in which the osseous nucleus is not very clear on the X-ray. So definitely, I think it has a role. Some of the cases have already been done in Lady Harding, in which they have planned deformity corrections in proximal femur using 3D printed models.
I think
Dr. Vikas,
Yes.
There is one more question for Dr. Anil Agarwal. Is he around? Dr. Anil? What is the earliest age you would advocate pelvic support osteotomy? And how do you calculate the proximal valgus angle, in this pelvic support? And it is a bit complicated in Choi article. Dr. Anil, we can't hear you.
He is muted, I think.
No. Dr. Anil.
Anil?
Vikas, you can take this question because we can't hear him.
Like, how do I plan these cases? Actually, basically...
No, what, first question is that what is the age you would like to do that? And then the second question is how you calculate the angle.
Actually, we all know, those who are the members of ASAMI, that if these are this Elisdorf hip reconstruction, that is pelvic support osteotomy, done before the age of 10, has a high chance of remodeling. So either you have to counsel the parents that the child might require repeated surgery. So I prefer to these cases only when the child is nearing the age 10 or nearing the skeletal maturity. So now calculating the angle, I think that's a, you know, radiographically you have to adduct the hip, and standing x-ray, then you calculate. So that's, I think, a different topic. How do you plan the Elisdorf hip reconstruction? So my only concern is that avoid doing the surgery in a child less than 10, unless it is necessary, especially the pelvic support osteotomy.
Actually, I can add
something to this.
I will add, you know, I think the better age is around 12 years.
Means, yeah, that is only after the age of 10, maybe. That's it.
Yeah, Dr. PN, you wanted
to... Yeah, I could just add a little technical tip and trick. One is that the osteotomy is usually done at the level of the ischial tuberosity. So wherever you find the ischial tuberosity, it is done at that level, number one. Number two is the how much abduction you do of the distal fragment. Is that you maximally adduct the hip and add about 15 degrees more. So that is the usual. So let's say the normal adduction is 45 degrees. And in a situation where there is a flail hip, that means there is no femoral head, the adduction is 60 degrees. So you have to add another 10 or 15 degrees to that. So 60 plus 10 would be around 70 degrees off.
Actually, that can be done on the table itself.
It is usually done on the table.
Under fluoroscopic guidance. Yeah.
Yes.
I think Manoj has come back.
Apologies from my end because my power went off and I just... So I presume that there has been some discussion on this. I listened to the last part of Lalit Meni's comments on 3D printing. So I think Kapil was alluding to arthrogram, and I'll just kind of briefly touch upon that and then move on to the next presentation, I think, because we are slightly overshoot. So in addition...
Manoj, can you take the opinion of Dr. Goel? He must be having a long experience.
Dr. Goel?
Sir?
He is muted.
Can you unmute?
Yeah, I'm making, sir.
No, sir, it's difficult.
I have unmuted him, sir.
Sir, Dr. Goel?
Yes.
Sir, what is your experience in these cases? These are very difficult cases and the outcome is not very good. So what is your long-term experience of managing these?
One thing you have to understand that some epiphysis is there for quite some time. Secondly, if you are operating, don't take out the epiphysis even if it looks loose. So, third, about the decision, how much abduction should be done for valgus osteotomy. The best decision is on the table. You adduct, fine. You add 10 degree, fine. But after doing osteotomy, use a K-wire, hold to what much valgus you want. And again, try to re-examine on the table whether this is sufficient or not. If it is not, you can increase the valgus at the same time. Because if you go with a fixed idea that, say, adduction is 30 degree and another 10 degree, it may not be helpful all the time. About the role of CT scan, MRI, and arthrogram, I would prefer an arthrogram to CT scan because CT scan, number one, is causes a lot of radiation. Secondly, you have to give anesthesia to the patient. Third, arthrogram is done at the time of surgery and you can take a call at that time.
Very valid point, sir. So as alluded to him, this was a case who had clear-cut sepsis as a child and 15 months presented. We didn't know what the cartilage was, so underwent an arthrogram and you can see that there is femoral head. That's the right side. It's deformed, but it's still there. Cartilage in his head. You can see in abduction, it is seated well. And similarly, you can see on the left side, which was completely missing, you can see with the arthrogram. Just to kind of introduce the concept of using an arthrogram, because you can get morphological information as well as dynamic evaluation. You see what is the position. Clearly, this is on reduction and axial loading. You can see it's subluxing. So all that we did was in the best fit position, a spica was put in. That's the child 6 months down the line, 2 years old. It's probably 9 months down the line. And that's a year later. You know, yes, there is damage, but you can see that there is some, as soon as you confer stability, you can see it starting to ossify. I think we'll stop there in this particular topic, otherwise we'll run out. And if I'm going to unshare my screen, and if Sanjay Swarup can start loading his talk for DDH.
Yeah, by the time, can I take one question from the audience?
Sure, sure.
Is there any role of trochanteric arthroplasty in case of total destruction of head and neck? And until which age we should go for it, or it is better to go ahead with pelvic support osteotomy?
So trochanteric, I'll take this answer and I'll kind of get somebody's opinion as well. Trochanteric arthroplasty hasn't had the greatest of results. There is the long-term published results have been that when it is done early enough, under the age of two, it has had some good results. But as a, it's not an alternative to pelvic support osteotomy. It's a situation wherein you have no head at all. In a very young child, you would consider a trochanteric arthroplasty in the hope that it would produce some sort of a femoral head.
And probably, Manoj, can I add? Hello?
Yes, you can add, you can add.
Yeah, the trochanteric arthroplasty may actually improve the radiographic outcome, but actually the clinical outcome is definitely not improved. Child may experience more pain, stiffness. So I think it has not become very popular, except there are a few papers from Mumbai, I suppose.
Dr. Ramni wants to give a comment. Dr. Ramni.
Yeah, no, I don't want to give a comment. I want to ask a question to Anil Agarwal. Can you hear me, Anil?
Yeah, can I'm audible, sir.
Yes, now you are audible. Now you are audible. Anil, I saw you using fibular grafts in one of your cases. I just wanted to know what is your actual indication. When do you use fibular grafts? And secondly, I found that you're not using too much of fixation along with the fibular grafts. I mean, is that deliberate? You just use a K-wire and...
Okay. Sir, the case was intervened because there was progressive coxa vara developing. And there was... We prefer using the fibular graft. There's no particular... method described. Actually, even without fibular graft, it has been shown that if you just do a valgus osteotomy, they will unite. But we prefer at the personal level using a fibular graft and a minimal implant in these cases, because we want to preserve the physis. It was a growing epiphysis there. You can see it growing in the serial X-ray. So we wanted to preserve the head, and so we use the minimum fixation and implant.
So what is the minimum age where you would use the fibular graft, wherever indicated?
So minimum 4.5 years, we would like to wait. More than 4 years, we would like to wait, sir, because it is difficult. The neck profile is so small that you can't use a fibular graft then.
Thank you.
Sanjay sir, can you upload your presentation now?
Yeah, okay. So basically, my topic, I'm supposed to speak on DDH. DDH is a big, long topic. And I thought one very interesting thing would be to help us, a talk which would help us determine whether we can diagnose a DDH accurately. And we should be sure that we are not missing any DDHs. So the title of the talk is Diagnosing DDH. Is it in or out? So you see, here is an X-ray of a missed DDH.
I can't see your screen, Sanjay.
You can't? Can everybody else see my screen?
Yeah, it's visible, sir.
Yes, we can see.
Oh, again, I'm messing up. I'm so sorry. Please
carry on. No worries. So a mature femoral head in a mature acetabulum is easy to locate on an X-ray. Like you can see here, this is a dislocated hip. You can see the head and you can see the CFE, and on this side also, it can be seen. However, in an immature hip, a large portion of the CFE is unossified. more acetabulum is cartilage. So therefore, the younger the child, the more difficult it is to locate the correct position. So how do we help ourselves in diagnosing a DDH? First of all, a diagnosis of DDH is easier if the CFE is visible. You can see on the right side, it is clearly visible and inside the acetabulum. On the left side, it is not visible, but you can see a little speck which indicates that there is a CFE present and it is clearly dislocated. This baby is 18 months old. So as they get older, it also becomes easier to diagnose them. Now, in a neutral hip, you have to take an X-ray, obviously, for a diagnosis in addition to the clinical examination. And the diagnosis in a neutral, it's done on a neutral hip. That means you have to take an AP X-ray of both hips. And there are certain lines which you would draw in this case. So the first one is called the Hilgen-Reiner's line. It connects the two triradiate cartilages at the corner of the acetabulum, which is formed by the ileum. So the other line is called the Perkins line, which is dropped at a 90 degree angle on the Hilgen-Reiner's line, and it runs along the lateral edge of the ossified acetabulum, whatever ossified acetabulum you see. Then you get these four quadrants. You get an inner two quadrants and outer two quadrants. And the CFE should always be located in the inner lower quadrant. So here on the opposite side, you can see that it is in the upper outer quadrant. So therefore it is dislocated. Then of course there is Shenton's line, which in the normal hip would be smooth, continuous. And in the abnormal hip, it would be discontinuous and broken. Then here is an infant hip, aged 5 months. So we do the same exercise. We draw the Hilgen-Reiner's line. We draw Perkins 1 and we draw Perkins 2. And you can see that the left hip is clearly dislocated. The right hip is suspicious, but it is, you could accept that because the child is immature and it is in the inner quadrant, in the inner lower quadrant. And the Shenton's line is smooth and continuous. So here is another child, 22 months of age. And if you draw the same lines, you can see that the hips are not quite located well enough on both sides, in the sense that this is also peaking out a little and this is also peaking. So on both sides, there is a certain degree of subluxation. Now, here is, we come to the same old X-ray. And in this, I add to whatever you all know, the acetabular index. Now, here we are. This is a line which is drawn along the roof of the ossified acetabulum and on the iliac side. And here is the Hilgen-Reiner's line again. And the angle formed between these two lines, that is the line drawn from the outer corner of the acetabulum to the triradiate cartilage to the Hilgen-Reiner's line, gives you acetabular index. And when you are diagnosing DDH, another thing to consider is the CFE size. You can see the CFE is very tiny here, and it is fairly good size and well ossified there. So these are the two other things I have added. And here you can see that the acetabular, this angle, the acetabular index, it is higher than the right side. That indicates that there is dysplasia of the acetabulum. That also aids in making your diagnosis of DDH. Now, what the other imaging modality which we use early on is ultrasound scan in DDH. Now, it is usually done up to age 3 months, and you have to combine it with a history. That means if there is a history of a breech, a female and a firstborn, or there is any family history of DDH, then you would do a clinical examination and an ultrasound. Here are two pictures. The one on the left side is showing you the Barlow's maneuver. Basically, you hold the pelvis stable between your thumb and the fingers, and you very gently adduct the hip and try to push it out, not forcibly, very gently. And if it gives you a sensation of going out, that's the Barlow's maneuver. And when you reverse the whole thing and pull it in, this is the Ortolani sign. So Barlow and Ortolani gives you an indication whether the hip is stable or unstable. And then the next thing you do is ultrasound scan. Now the ultrasound scan assesses acetabular dysplasia by the alpha angle, and it displays assesses the, this is your iliac. This is the ileum. That's the head of the CFE. This is the acetabulum, and this is the labrum. So here we are. This is your alpha angle, and it gives you basically the idea of how sloped the roof is, and that's the beta angle. And you have to assess dynamic stability, and or you always need a follow-up X-ray. So you can see the alpha angle here is 60 degrees, and the beta angle is also reasonable. It's about 45 degrees. There you are. This is the patient on whom the ultrasound was done. And this is the same child at, I think, 16 months or 14 months of age, where all these lines are drawn. And you can see that the left side is showing a little bit of a dysplasia as compared to the right side. Now, arthrogram. We just spoke about the arthrogram in context of the septic hip. Arthrogram is important as an imaging modality in DDH, but usually we use it as an intraoperative tool. So this is an arthrogram on one of my patients. It is used to assess reduction. It is also used to assess the maintenance of reduction in hip spica. Once you're given a hip spica, as is shown here, then you can see the outline of the femoral head and you can see it pointing to the triradiate cartilage. So you know that it's in there. And this is especially useful when CFE is poorly ossified or unossified. Then it's very, very useful. And of course, the arthrogram also assesses the medial pooling of the dye, whether the limbus is inverted and all those other things. But it's an assessment of DDH as a part of its treatment, not for diagnosing it. Now, once you've done your close reduction, you hold the baby in a human position in a hip spica, as I have shown here, and radiographs are done later on. The CFE should point to the triradiate cartilage, and there is a reverse Shenton line. It should be again smooth and discontinuous. So that gives you an assessment of the quality of your reduction. And it is routine for us to do an AP and a lateral view on X-rays after reduction to see whether our reduction is good enough. Now, here is a female, 1 year. I'm just giving you an example. She had close reduction, adductor tenotomy, and a hip spica. This hip was out, and this is post reduction. As you can see here, this hip is standing out a little. So is it an acceptable reduction? We don't know. Now, what is the imaging modality which we can use to confirm? So we use a post reduction CT scan. And on the CT scan, we can see that the triradiate is here, and the CFE, the hip is pointing towards the CFE. So we are satisfied that everything is going fine. And here is the child 18 months post-reduction. You can see that the hip is located, although there is significant amounts of acetabular dysplasia present on the X-ray. Now, the issue of residual dysplasia and subluxation, again, we go a step higher. We go beyond the diagnosis of DDH to a little more. Now, here is a situation. This is the kid in the X-ray on the left side. He shows clearly that there is residual dysplasia in the hip joint. Now, how do we diagnose all this? We have a few tools at our disposal. So we draw the Hilgen-Reiner's line, and we check the acetabular index. Now, if in my practice, the acetabular index is less than 30, I worry less. If it is more than 30, it definitely rings an alarm bell. The second thing you do is you draw the Perkins line and you draw the center edge angle. So this is the lateral center edge angle. And again, it gives you an idea on the shift of the femoral head outside. And the CE angle should be always more than 25 degrees. That means the hip should be located inwards. Okay. The third thing you measure is basically the Reimer's extrusion index, in the sense that you measure the whole width of the physis, and then you see where the Perkins line is cutting it. And the Reimer's extrusion index should also be within normal limits, which is about 15%. So there we are. Now, here is another example for you. This is a 2-year-old female. She has undergone close reduction, adductor tenotomy, and a hip spica. And she had a successful close reduction, but her acetabular dysplasia measures 36 degrees on the right side, as opposed to normal 20 degrees on the left side at age 3 years. So this worries us because 36 is a lot.
and there is some increase in the distance between the CFE and the teardrop. So it tells us that the hip is also subluxating a bit. So what we did is we did a DIGA osteotomy for this kid at 3 years and 8 months, and at 5 years and 3 months, you can see that the hip is well reduced and well located, and it is concentric. Sir, can we have
one
of the mics?
Please.
Can we mute the mics, please?
Please mute your mics.
I have muted him, sir.
Thank you. Thanks very much. So, residual dysplasia is a big question with pediatric orthopedic surgeons as well as adult orthopedic surgeons. When should you worry? First of all, if you have treated a child with DDH, the serial x-rays should document an improvement, and you can consult the tonuses chart to see what is normal and what is not normal. As I told you before, if you get an acetabular index of 30 degrees or less, you should worry less. But if you get an acetabular index of more than 30 degrees, then you have to worry about this dysplasia. But there are other things also. If you do an ultrasound scan, now ultrasound scan, graph 2A, we say don't worry. But if your alpha angle is less than 55 degrees, even if it is a 2A, there is a very high chance that this thing will progress and become worse. Or if over a period of ultrasound scans, you see the 2A is not improving, so there is a maturation deficit, again, you have to worry and offer some sort of a containment, which is usually a brace to these kids. Then if you have signs of instability on an x-ray, for instance, giving an example, if there is a mild subluxation on an x-ray and then you do an abduction view and the hip relocates nicely, that means the hip is unstable. So you have to worry. Reimer's extrusion index, as I showed you before, is over 20%. The lateral CE angle is over 20 degrees. Acetabular index is over 30 degrees and femoral antiversion is over 25 degrees in the settings of a DDH, then you have to worry about the dysplasia and you have to consider that you might need to treat it over a period of time at some point in the future. Now, decision-making in the older child. Here is a very beautiful example. This is a 13-year-old girl. She came to us with a previously treated DDH, AVN here, and we focused on this hip and decided to do an open reduction and a femoral osteotomy and a Bernese osteotomy. So we managed to relocate this hip very nicely. And but the question was, what about the opposite side? Now, you on the first glance, you may think that it's not of any great concern. But when you look at it carefully, you will see that there is an increased distance here. And the lateral CE angle, if it is under 20 degrees, or the tonus roof angle is over 15 degrees, or femoral head covering uncovering is 31%, then there is 100% osteoarthritis by age 65 years. So it was important, in view of the destroyed left hip, it was important for us to preserve the right side, the right hip. And she met, she fulfilled our requirements for a acetabular procedure because her extrusion was a little over 25 degrees and the tonus roof angle was also not satisfactory and the lateral CE angle was also over our acceptable limit. So she had, here we are, that's the roof angle, that is the extrusion, this is the CE angle. And so post-operatively, she had this is the post-operative view of her Bernese osteotomy. And this was a few years ago, and she is doing quite well with her both right as well as the left hips. So this gives you some idea about how to diagnose DDH. When you have diagnosed it, you have treated it, how to follow up upon its dysplasia, and when to stop following them up, because usually you must follow them up till age 12 years. And I hope this has imparted some information. Thank you.
Thanks, Sanjay. Very comprehensive talk on DDH.
Manoj, I have a question from audience. Can we take it now?
Sure.
Okay. So, Dr. Sanjay, is there any role of preoperative traction in DDH before closed and open reduction in a child more than 6 months?
Yeah, that's quite an interesting question. Initially, when I started training, we used to give tractions.
then we were told that tractions cause an increase in the rate of avascular necrosis if you do an open reduction. Yet there is a lot of literature to the contrary now, and it seems that there are a few papers out there which advocate the use of traction, and they seem to say that you can get a better result once you have given traction. I don't.
I agree with Sanjay, and I think most of us don't. He's correct about the papers, but as it coincidentally, there was a session this morning in Kosi from the Japanese who have presented series on traction. But it's not a universally accepted practice, or it's universally not practiced currently. I wouldn't say accepted, not it's, universally practiced.
It seemed a bit extreme. If you look at that Japanese paper, they have given up to 19 months of hip spica to children. 19 months.
Yeah.
I don't know, really.
Any other question, Dr. Manish?
No, no. Can I say something?
Yes, please, Dr. Sharad.
Dr. Sanjay, excellent presentation. I want to know that many of the children at the birth, I mean, in the first week, second week, they have a abnormality in maybe mild subluxation and mild discrepancy in the imaging. In such cases, would you like to wait for a certain period that many of them they correct on their own, or do you start treating intervening immediately?
So if there is a minor degree of hip immaturity, let us say you got an ultrasound done and it says it's graft 2A, then you would certainly like to wait and just advise the family to do a little bit of abduction exercise and repeat an ultrasound again at 6 weeks. If at 6 weeks you have no progression with the immaturity, or if the numbers are wrong or it shows clearly dysplasia, then you will have to treat. I do not subscribe to the belief that you should wait up to 3 months before you start putting them into a public harness. I feel that you should intervene at the most by 6 weeks. But these are personal views only. They are not really, many people would like to wait for 3 months also.
Dr. Sanjay.
Sir.
Dr. Manoj, can I ask something?
Yeah,
Dr.
Please.
Sanjay?
Yeah, yes, yeah.
Go ahead.
Thanks for the
Your audio is not clear.
Presentation. We just want to routines. Hello. Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Dr. Sanjay, is there any protocol of doing the routine ultrasound screening of all the hips of the children born in your hospital?
No. If I can get the question correctly, I think Dr. Arora, you want to know if we should ultrasound screen all kids.
Yes. Who are taking place? Yes.
So I don't think so, because the incidence of dysplasia is very low in our country, and routine screening for all children is not a practice that I would recommend. I would certainly say screen all the high risk ones, with a clinical examination, and wherever there is a doubt, do an X-ray at 4 to 5 months of age to make sure that you got everything right.
All right, thank you. Because when I was in case, they have a routine screening of all the children born in their hospitals, in Dudley group of hospitals. I think nowadays maybe they are also changing the practice.
Yeah, yeah. Because
has a question.
It did not lower the incidence of late presenting DDHs in those populations there. And here there is certainly no case at all to routinely screen everybody.
Yeah, Sanjay, nice presentation.
Thank you very much.
Just wanted to, your comment just now, which said that the DDH is very, it's not very common. See, the thing is now we are doing that survey. Remember, we are doing a POSI survey, DDH survey.
Yeah.
So when actually we're looking at the spectrum of DDH, which includes the instability also, we have realized that, the incidence of DDH is a little bit more than what we expected. That is one comment, but my questions are a couple. One is that I find you using Reimer's index in DDH, which is Reimer's index was basically given for cerebral palsy. So how useful you find this Reimer's index in DDH? One question. Second one is, you talked about the use of ultrasounds to determine whether there is a residual establishment dysplasia, which means that you are actually advocating ultrasounds in older children also.
No, to answer the last question first, I think you misunderstand, or maybe I did not convey myself properly. Ultrasound is useful only up to three and a half months of age, and to assess residual dysplasia in the sense that supposing you are following up a kid who you detected with an instability or immaturity early on at week two, then you would certainly follow up on the ultrasound at week four, five, whatever your protocol is, but certainly not more than 3 months, because after that the head ossifies and becomes difficult to do an ultrasound. Now, the first question was use of Reimer's index. Reimer's index is one of the indicators of an extrusion and hence instability, and it is used in DDH to allow you to make a treatment pathway, in the sense that if you are getting a Reimer's index that is progressive, then you have to intervene because the hip is walking out, basically. And usually you have to intervene with a bony procedure because you do not rely on soft tissues that are already worn out and are about to fail.
Yeah, that's fine. See, coming back to the ultrasound, you said that you don't use ultrasounds beyond 3 months. That is understandable.
Yeah.
Now, how does ultrasound then help you to label something as a residual establishment dysplasia? That's what I'm asking.
Oh, I see. I see. Well,
I didn't understand the context.
Yeah. Basically, I put up that slide in residual dysplasia, but it is I just showed from something from age 0 to 12. These are the various ways in which you can determine whether you have to intervene or not intervene. Now, supposing you have a 2A, graph 2A on ultrasound, and this baby is still maintaining an alpha angle of, let's say, 55 degrees at 6 weeks, 7 weeks, 8 weeks, then at that point, you would have to put in a Pavlik harness. That means that is your intervention, which you put into this patient based on the ultrasounds that you had.
But that's not a residual establishment dysplasia. You basically treating.
We'll take this discussion offline on that.
Okay. Right. Thank you.
Overrun, and we'll just quickly run through a few cases just to kind of get the other panelists involved and give a flavor of, kind of distill the information which has been given by Sanjay. So this is the first case, which is a 10-month-old who was found to be dislocated. Now, PN Gupta and Vikas, could you kind of tell me what your thinking would be on these, interpreting these x-rays? PN first.
Yeah. So this is, this looks like a DDH of the left side with an unossified femoral head. So there's a little bit of dysplasia of the acetabulum as well. So my choice would be a closed reduction and evaluate that reduction with arthrogram and put in a spica.
Okay. Under anesthesia, right?
Yeah, obviously under anesthesia. Yes.
Because are you happy with that plan? And let us say I'm going to kind of throw it. Suppose you can't reduce this close at this age. Do you encounter that scenario, or would you say this has to be treated close because it's a 10-month-old? Because?
Yeah, the close treatment remains the first choice, considering the age of the child, and that has to be now collaborated with the arthrogram, intraoperative arthrogram. So the reduction is concentric, the hip is stable in a normal abduction, not in a wide abduction or internal patient. I will definitely go with the close reduction and probably get the post-op CT scan, single section CT scan, to confirm the reduction has been maintained, and follow this child.
If you cannot get it closed?
If it cannot get closed, I think you can go ahead with the open reduction at this age. Although there are some papers when they point out that when capital femoral epiphyse is not obvious radiographically, the chances of AVN are high. But I think it's a borderline age, and as early the hip is reduced, the better would be the outcome.
Raymond, are you concerned about opening this hip if it is not reducing close? Are you worried that the ossific nucleus has not appeared?
Are you asking me?
Raymond.
Yes. So, no. See, my as far as my practice goes, Manoj, my subconscious cutoff between closed reduction and open reduction is 10 months. But that doesn't mean that I'm not going to try a closed reduction here, but my consent will be very clear. It will be an adductor tenotomy, closed reduction, arthrogram, failing which I would do an open reduction and hip spica. So that's the way I would approach this. And I won't hesitate to do an open reduction through an anterior approach, which I usually do.
Yeah. So this, unfortunately, this patient, unfortunately, whatever, did not have a successful closed reduction. So I agreed to all the panelists what they've said, that yes, closed reduction would be your first kind of management. But if you cannot get a satisfactory reduction, you would need to open it. You shouldn't have any hesitation in opening up, and therefore you should consent appropriately. And the importance of following up longitudinally, bringing to highlight what Sanjay said about long-term follow-up and residual dysplasia. So that is 3 years post-op, and you can see that there are no issues. Okay, so I'm going to try to distill some points on it. Here is a second one. This I'm going to ask Dr. Kapil Gangwal. So this is an older child, 13 months. Now it's gone beyond 12 months. Now, would you still consider closed reduction, or this is one for straight away a primary open reduction?
So Manoj, closed reduction, one can attempt up till 1.5 years of age, theoretically. The success of the closed reduction progressively reduces as the age advances. So definitely I would try a closed reduction. Although for this hip, if you ask me, I'll be a little suspicious whether it's a DDH or whether it was post-septic sequelae, because I see a teardrop on that side, although there's a significant amount of vestibular dysplasia. So the teardrop actually is present, then it kind of adds a little suspicion in the mind that is this post-septic.
No. Dr. Goel, sir, if you can, what would be your thought on it? This is a 13-month-old child now. Would you advocate a trial of closed reduction before opening, Dr. Goel?
I quite agree with Kapil. And I think we should try a closed reduction. I have done it up to 1.5 years. And if it fails, then only we should go for open reduction. Of course, in this case, the C angle is also very high. So chances of staying there would be less. But we should try a closed reduction.
Manoj, can I
ask you? Do you want to kind of comment on it, Sanjay? Sanjay Saroop?
Manoj, can I ask you a question?
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, regarding that first case, had the child been 6 months old and the closed reduction fails, so would you go for open reduction at this age? And if open reduction, which approach?
That's a very hypothetical question. At 6 months, I would expect closed reduction to kind of succeed very well. I am not a big proponent of, I think you're asking about whether I would go in for a medial approach open reduction. I'm personally not a big fan of medial approach open reduction. And at 6 months, yes, it's probably the lowest that I would consider an anterior. But I would probably wait for a little, simply because the child is a bit bigger. So that's one situation wherein I probably would delay. But if people are comfortable with the medial approach, they would probably do it. Some people are comfortable even doing an open reduction at 6 months. So I think it's what you're comfortable with. At 6 months, I would say closed reduction. If it fails, I probably would wait until the child is a bit older. I am not comfortable with the medial approach open reduction. So this one, went in. So what I'm trying to highlight here is like the age itself is not the biggest determinant. You should always try a closed reduction. Like Dr. Goel and Kapil Gangwal said, up to 18 months you can have, but you need to kind of make sure that you don't force the hip in. Important to keep it under follow-up. You can still see the dysplasia. Sanjay, are you there? Are you there with us?
Yeah.
Two-plus-year-old. Are you now? What is going on in your mind regarding the acetabular indices and things like that?
How old is this kid?
The kid is now 2+, 1 year post-op, 1 year post-op closed reduction.
Well, I can see that there is a fair amount of acetabular dysplasia. The CFE looks like it has suffered some insult, but that this is not very clear right now. If the dysplasia measures about 30 degrees, I'll be very satisfied, but I would still continue the containment in this kid. I would continue him with an abduction brace. Till a time I'm satisfied that the acetabular index has reduced to less than 30 degrees. And then there should be no difference between an abduction view and a normal neutral view in terms of the extrusion. hair extrusion looks quite normal. Huh? It doesn't look like it is walking out.
Okay. So by which you mean there is no instability?
There is no instability, I think.
Yeah. So I agree with him. So I agree with this. I thought there was no instability. Clinically didn't feel unstable. Continued with the follow-up. The key for this is that what I'm trying to convey to the audience is that you need follow-up. You need to kind of monitor them up. So this is now 2 years post-op, 3+ years old. And as you can see that the indices are getting normal. So that's now 5. Would you be happy with this at this stage, Alok?
Yeah, I mean, this seems to be very good actually, but my cutoff age for close reduction, I differ from you. I keep it at 6 months.
You need to come a bit closer to the mic or speak.
Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yeah. Yeah, better.
So you need to speak into the mic, Alok.
Yeah, I'm speaking in the mic. Yeah. I'm audible?
Better.
So my cutoff age for close reduction and open reduction is 6 months. So I usually do not try close reductions after 6 months, which might be a little more aggressive. But as far as my experience tells me, my cutoff age is 6 months. But you have beautiful result even at 18 months. This is commendable.
That's a long follow-up. Sanjay?
What I'm trying to say is that follow-up is very important. Even a case that looks as good as this, you especially the danger years are 8 and 9 and 10, in which a type 2 AVN will manifest by lateral physial overgrowth and extrusion and a coxa valga. So you have to be careful about that.
Before I move on to the next.
Yeah, topic, just one case. Question.
Vikas?
Yeah, did you use abduction brace in this case?
I don't. So I know Sanjay is a proponent and there are amongst a lot of other people as well. So I don't use a lot of extensive bracing. So I use, once a spica removal, I kind of put the brace for about, maybe 6 weeks, 3 weeks.
Not during follow-up. Yeah.
Nothing else.
Manoj.
If I can, yeah.
Dr. Manoj, can you hear me?
Yes, Manish.
There is one question from audience that what investigation should be done in follow-up to document that there is a reduction of the hip?
There is a reduction. Sanjay, do you want to take that?
An X-ray, I think.
Yeah. Post-immediate reduction, is that the question or follow-up?
No, follow-up.
X-rays.
Follow-up. That's all you can do.
X-ray pelvis, yeah.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, sure.
We need to get to the next topic.
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Yeah, Ramani.
I want to make a comment. You know, when you are attempting close reductions in older children, in the sense relatively older children, like more than 1 year, then you should have a very low threshold to open reduction if and without any over-enthusiastic pressure on the femoral head to achieve that close reduction, which you subconsciously want to get. So the chances of AVN automatically increase if you are pushing and pulling and putting too much of pressure on the head. So that is one point which I just wanted to make.
I think that's been this thing that close reduction, I think Vikas alluded to, that you shouldn't get into extreme positions and use a lot of force. I think
that's right. It should gently get inside the spot. Yes.
Dr. Manish?
Yes, there is one more question. How frequently we should follow up after applying hip spica? And how to assess the status of hip since we can't do ultrasound with hip spica?
Sanjay, I think it's covered.
Yeah,
in Sanjay's talk,
it is covered. Basically, you bring them in at, post-op x-rays, AP and lateral views. And then you repeat the same at 3 weeks, at 6 weeks, and at 3 months. Usually at 6 weeks, you may need to change the hip spica because it usually gets soiled and all. But at 3 months, then when you remove the hip spica, you take another x-ray. All being satisfactory, bracing, etc., then x-rays are done once in 6 months till dysplasia resolves. And again, as I said, you have to monitor them ages 7, 8, 9, 10.
I think there was last case. I'll just take a couple of minutes on this. This is again, I think, touching upon the relevance of subtle clinical signs. This is a child who just was brought because of altered gait and just the tendency to keep the left lower limb externally rotated. There's a risk factor of a breach. And I think somebody from the audience asked about clinical findings. There was asymmetry, restriction of abduction, and some amount of telescopy. Now, with this findings, Kapil, would you want to kind of say, you know, I mean, the X-ray looks fine, or is there any subtle cause of concern here?
Well, Manoj, I think the hip does look a little lateralized. Maybe if you do a CE angle, there is some kind of a little extrusion on the left. And a little bit of acetabular dysplasia, maybe. So at this point, I really won't go in for any investigation. I'd probably put this kid in a hip abduction brace, ambulatory hip abduction brace, and follow him every 3 months. If the hip dysplasia fails to improve by like 2-3 years of age, maybe I'd consider a acetabular procedure at that time.
PN Gupta, would you want to kind of be certain that this is not unstable? Would you want to evaluate it, or would you just put in a brace?
I would put it in a brace. This looks stable enough to me. However, I would do a clinical evaluation. And if I have a doubt, I would actually evaluate this child under a C-arm. Dynamic fluoroscopy.
Under anesthesia, yeah.
So yeah. And I mean, first clinical, and then if I have a doubt, then I will take him under anesthesia.
Yeah.
So, but I agree with Dr. Kapil that I would put him in a brace and observe the child till around 4 years of age or so.
Yeah. So both those options were discussed. The family wanted to be absolutely sure that, you know, if it needed to be addressed, this needed to be addressed. And you can't be certain about instability unless you examine it under anesthesia. Because the index is definitely, there's a huge asymmetry there. And they chose the option of having it evaluated, which would mean under anesthesia and an arthrogram. So would you be concerned on this arthrogram that there is instability, Sanjay? On the bottom picture, well, I think axial, adducted axial loading.
There is a significant medial pooling of dye, but I had already made up my mind about instability when I saw the X-ray because the CE angle was low. It was less than 10 degrees to my kind of unmeasured this thing. I mean, I didn't actually put a scale on it, but I just thought that when you look at the CE angle, it is less than 10 degrees. So definitely a case for some kind of intervention. Bracing would be fine, I think, for a while.
Would anybody, Ramani, would you want to put a hip spica or a brace, Ramani?
Maybe just for a little while, because 36 is it's not, I won't accept 36. I use brace, you know. I would start with a full-time use of the brace and ask the patient to come back after with a hinge and try to maintain the flexion extension and keep it on 22 hours out of 24 hours and ask the patient come back after 4 months and hope, keep my fingers crossed that the acetabular index comes down.
Dr. Goyal, would you...
Dr. Manoj, I would just wish to add, Dr. Manoj.
Goyal. Dr. Goyal,
I think brace should be enough. We should follow, keep a brace only. Plaster is not required.
Dr. Manoj, can I add something?
Yes, please.
Yeah, to me, arthrogram for this radiographic picture seems to be overkill.
Well, I mean, so that's an interpretation. It's a discussion with the family.
Because it's not actually going to change your management.
Well, I my plan for this would be a spica. So my plan, I would not put, because I'm not a bracer in that sense. So I put a spica. So my management differs. I'm certain that there is instability and therefore a spica.
Okay.
Can I ask a question, Manoj?
Yeah.
See, I have been listening to you that you don't you don't use brace. So after a close reduction, what is your follow-up? Suppose you do a close reduction at 4 months of age. So what is your follow-up? I mean, it's important to
understand. Close reduction would have a spica for 3 months. A spica changes. At 3 months, they come out into a brace. Mm. The brace would be for 3 weeks full-time and 3 weeks night-time. Nothing more.
After that, you just leave the hip out of everything?
Well, they don't go out. I just see them out of the
brace. No. Out of everything.
So I agree. So what we need to convey to the audience is that world over, it's not a universal concept. Bracing is there. Lots of people brace. Lots of people don't brace. So I think it's depending on what your individual practices are. There are a lot of people who are vehemently against any form of bracing, but a lot of people use various kinds of braces. And I am not a bracer. That's all I'm saying.
No, but that means you don't believe that the brace might actually reduce the incidence of a residual acetabular dysplasia, especially after close reduction?
I haven't seen. I have a very low threshold to kind of be certain that there is no instability. If there is instability, I don't think bracing is going to help. If it is, so I think that's a subject for, you know, another discussion altogether.
Absolutely. I understand that. But, you know, the message to the audience should be clear. That's what I'm saying.
But that's exactly what I'm saying. The evidence is not that it is universal bracing. There is plenty of people who do not brace. That's what I'm saying. So you depends on what you're saying. That's not the standard universal practice. I fully accept that there are plenty of people who brace. I think we'll move on to the next one, which is, I think, Alok Sood going to talk on Perthes. I think we are running quite late, so probably we may not have a lot of discussions. Alok, if you could, I'll stop sharing. And if Alok can come in with Perthes.
Alok is muted. Ravi, unmute him.
We can't hear anything.
Unmute, sir.
Alok is muted.
Dr. Alok, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can. Can you see it? Can you see the presentation?
No, please start sharing your screen.
I'm sorry.
Share your screen first, sir.
Yeah, can you see it now?
Yeah. It's visible, sir.
Yes, we can.
Is that okay?
Yeah, sir. Please, yeah. Sir, please play it.
Yeah. Is it okay?
Yeah, now you can go ahead, sir.
So good evening. I'll be talking about Perthes disease, and as we know that Perthes disease itself is a huge topic. So I've just picked up role of imaging in the management, which is
quite. Sir, your sound is not that much good.
Yeah, to be.
Can you be a little louder?
Is it okay?
Yeah.
Not that much.
Not yet. Not yet. Not yet. Still
increase
more.
Increase the volume of in your computer,
and come close to the mic, sir. Better to come.
I'm speaking right into the mic.
And just increase the volume. I think it is better now. But if you can increase the volume.
Is it okay now?
Better. Yeah, it will be better than before, sir.
Yeah. So it is a huge topic, and I've just picked up the role of imaging in management. I hope I'm audible now. Now, before we know that what is to be seen, we must know what's happening inside the hip joint. So it all starts with a small vascular insult initially, which results in a subchondral fracture, resulting in inflammatory response of synovitis and articular cartilage hypertrophy, and that results in femoral head extrusion. Now, aim of the treatment is to prevent this femoral head extrusion, because if we contain the femoral head, the sphericity of the acetabulum will mold the femoral head again into a sphere. We do not want that this femoral head, it goes into asphericity. So basic aim of the management is to contain the femoral head. Now, when to contain the femoral head, the imaging is going to tell us. Now, there are various imaging modalities which are available to us. Number one, which is used most commonly, is the plain radiograph, followed by arthrogram. Now,
sir, sorry to interrupt, but your sound is not clear, actually.
It's not clear. Okay, I'll change my... Just a minute.
Yeah, please increase your volume, sir.
Just a
minute. Use headphone.
Yeah, I'm using headphone. Yeah, is it? Am I audible now?
You are audible, but sir, sound is not that much clear actually.
I've changed my. Is it
okay? Dr. Alok, increase the volume in your computer.
Increase the volume. Okay. I'll have to, you know, go out of the slideshow.
Now it's better then.
Now it is better.
Better? Okay. So yeah. The imaging modalities, they are plain radiographs, an arthrogram, and an MRI. Now, it is basically the plain radiographs which is used mostly. Plain radiographs will tell us two things. The staging, which tells us the pathophysiology, that is, in what stage we have caught the patient, and classification, which tells us what to do with the patient with this disease and what is the prognosis. So staging was first described by Waldenstrom, and staging tells us what's happening. So stage one, it equals to the initial vascular insult. Now, whenever the vascular insult happens, the ossific nucleus, it becomes smaller, right? It becomes denser because now the dynamic calcium exchange is not happening. Now, this ossific nucleus, because of the vascular insult, has stopped receiving its nutrition. However, the articular cartilage, which is sitting on top of it, it still gets its nutrition from the synovial fluid. And that is why it becomes hypertrophic as compared to the ossific nucleus. That results in increase of the medial joint space. This increase in the medial joint space is sometimes called Waldenstrom sign. So this is the first stage. The second stage, once the vascular insult has happened, there might be micro damage to the ossific nucleus. This ossific nucleus micro damage, it presents as a subchondral fracture. You can see this translucent line, right? This translucent line is a subchondral fracture. Now, once this subchondral fracture has happened, as I told you earlier, there will be inflammatory response, right? There will be synovitis, there will be cartilage and ligamentum teres hypertrophy, and that results in extrusion of the epiphysis. Now, once this extrusion has happened, all the stresses of the lateral edge of the acetabulum, they concentrate on this part of the femoral head, and that results in disintegration or collapse of the epiphysis or the lateral pillar. So this is the stage where you have to put this extruded epiphysis again back into the acetabulum so that the sphericity of the acetabulum can be utilized to produce a spherical femoral head. Now, whereas stage two is the active stage, stage three is the healing stage. Now, the bone has started to form. However, this bone is still trabecular bone, which is soft enough to allow a plasticity. So even in the early part of healing stage, that is stage three, if we will put this head inside the acetabulum, it will be able to take the advantage of biological plasticity, which is conferred upon it by the acetabulum, and we can still achieve a spherical head. However, stage four is the healed. Over here, whatever healing has happened, and the trabecular bone is now, it has now been replaced by the lamellar bone, so that the head, it resumes its normal ossification, its normal strength, and it will be unable to change even if you will put it inside the acetabulum. So this is more or less permanent. So that is the summary of evolution. Now coming to the classification. So we know now what is staging, right? Staging is going to tell us only the pathophysiology which is happening, which is from avascular insult to fragmentation and to reossification. Now classification, on the other hand, they tell us about the treatment part and the prognosis, right? Now the most important and most popular classification is the Catrull classification. Now this is dependent upon the epiphyseal involvement. Catrull 1 and 2, initially there were four stages of Catrull, right? But they are of late labeled into packed into two. Catrull 1 and Catrull 2, they are those where the amount of epiphyseal involvement is less than 50%, right? Catrull 3 and Catrull 4 are those where the amount of epiphyseal involvement is more than 50%. However, on a plain X-ray, there is poor inter-observer reliability, and that is why on a plain X-ray, this classification is not a very good classification. In addition to this, that is the amount of epiphyseal involvement, Catrull also described 5 headed risk signs. Now, these are important. These 5 headed risk signs were the metaphyseal cyst formation, horizontal epiphyseal plate, ossification lateral to the epiphysis, and a gate sign, right? Gate sign is nothing but a V-shaped translucency on the lateral part of the epiphysis, which tells us that there is a vascular insult. Now, headed risk signs were added to Catrull classification so as to tell us that which cases should be operated upon and which cases can be just managed with conservative management, right? So this is followed by Salter-Thompson classification, because a lot of even intra-observer variability was there with Catrull. So they thought of making subchondral fracture as the mark of classification. So subchondral fracture can be more clearly seen, right? But the problem is that it can be seen only in early stages and it can be seen only in a third of patients. So when you see a subchondral fracture, it appears like this, right? And it is called a crescent sign. When it spans less than 50% of the epiphysis, this is type 1, more than 50% is type 2. And it is very strongly correlated with the prognosis. Now, both these classifications have their own pros and cons. And bearing this in mind, another classification was floated, which was more objective. This was given by Haring, and it is called lateral pillar classification. It depends upon the height of the lateral pillar. Now you can see that on this side, this is the height of the lateral pillar, whereas on this side, this height has greatly reduced, it has flattened. So type A is where there is no loss. Type B, the loss is less than 50% height, and type C is when the loss of height is more than 50%. You can see that this is approximately type B and this is definitely type C. So prognosis and treatment. So the prognosis, what are the radiological criteria on the basis of which the prognosis depends, right? It is the area of epiphyseal involvement according to Cattell. It is the epiphyseal collapse, that is lateral pillar collapse according to Haring. The epiphyseal extrusion, metaphyseal changes, and headed risk signs, out of which epiphyseal extrusion is the most important because ultimately it is the epiphyseal extrusion which can be corrected. Now, if you see this boy, you can see that there is headed risk sign, there is calcification lateral to the epiphysis, there is fragmentation, and pole of the epiphysis is involved, right? So it is a Waldenstrom type 2B. Right, that is the stage. It is in the stage of fragmentation. It is Cattell type 4, that is whole of the epiphysis is involved. Salter and Thompson cannot be commented upon because you cannot see a crescent sign, and Haring is type B, right? Another example, right? The metaphyseal cysts are there. The epiphyseal plate line is almost horizontal and there is flattening, right? There is whole of epiphysis which is involved. And if in another view, you can see a crescent sign, which is almost spanning whole of the epiphysis. See the extent of it starts from here laterally and medially it goes still here, right? So this is a bad prognosis. This is Salter Thompson type 2, Cattell type 4, and Haring in BC, that is in between B and C. So treatment guidelines. So why should the imaging be done? The imaging is done because it tells us how to treat and where to treat. Now, this is very important for the postgraduates and residents, and they must listen to this slide very carefully. Now, when the age is 5 to 8 years, that is in a younger child, when the classification is lower, on the lower side, that is less than 50% of the physis is involved, of the epiphysis is involved, or it is Haring A, or less than B, there are, in this scenario, there are two conditions. Number one, there is no loss of motion, and number two, there is loss of motion. So when there is no loss of motion, nothing needs to be done to this child except active assisted exercises, putting him on skin traction when it is symptomatic. Active assisted exercises are done to maintain the range of motion. Now, when there is loss of range of motion, then this can be tackled with an adductor tenotomy, followed by traction or a Petri's cast for around 6 weeks. Right? It can be more also. However, all these kids, they will have to be followed up radiologically every 4 to 6 months to see progression or extrusion. Right? On progression, you basically see extrusion and you intervene whenever first sign of extrusion is present. Now, within this age group, that is 5 to 8 years, if a higher classification presents to you or epiphyseal extrusion is there, then it is better to go for containment. Now, this paper, this presentation is not about what form of containment, but containment has to be given. And in literature, there is better evidence for operative containment than non-operative containment in any age group. Now, coming to age, which is more than 8 years. In age, which is more than 8 years, regardless of the classification, you have to intervene, right? That means you have to contain this hip. Now, this containment can be non-operative, as I already told, or operative, but there is better evidence for operative method, right? Whether this child presents in early stage or late stage, it has to be contained. However, in late stages, there is another factor which now gets attached, that is the shape of the head. Because the child is older and the head is already flat. If head is already flat, then containment will have poor results or it will not give you the desired result. So I hope that treatment guideline is clear to you, but we can have deviation from this guideline from various authors, right? Now let's take a few examples. Now, this is the patient. You can clearly see that there is a vascular insert over here, right? There is extrusion as seen by the Reimer's index, right? There is a gate sign which is present. However, it is, and the head is going into flattening. However, there is some congruity which is still maintained. So this was the right time to intervene. So we are not discussing about the method of containment. What is important is containment, right? So we usually do in our institute containment by a proximal femoral osteotomy. And you can see that we began with this, and just look at the sphericity of the head. It has healed beautifully. So you have to use the biological plasticity offered by the acetabulum onto the femoral head, which through which the femoral head, it regains its shape, right? Now, another case, I was telling you about this late presenting girl, right? Already the head is flat, right? There is extrusion. This is herring type C. And even when we have done a proximal femoral osteotomy, it has not produced a desired result. And probably this has to be augmented by an acetabular procedure like shelf. Now, another case, this is a younger patient, but with bilateral involvement. Now we know that bilateral, whenever there is bilateral involvement, the prognosis is worse. And that is why these cases should be dealt with more aggressively and probably operative management, which is done earlier, right? So on both sides, a proximal femoral varus osteotomy was done. And just look how the heads have been converted into good spheres, right? They are on both sides, there is congruency, there is sphericity, right? Now, outcome after healing is usually seen by Stuhlberg's classification. It depends upon the shape, size, and congruency of the femoral head, right? And more importantly, on the femoral head coverage, right? The femoral head coverage, as we have already discussed, depends upon the Reimer's index. Now, this is the part of the head which is lying outside. So this line divided by this line into 100 gives you Reimer's index. This line divided by this into 100 will also give you Reimer's index. The percentage will come out to be same, whether the denominator is this, right? The smaller line, this one, or the bigger line, this one, right? When it exceeds 15 to 20%, that means there is significant amount of femoral head uncoverage and you need to intervene. The other things besides the shape, size, congruency, and femoral head coverage, which tell us the outcome, are the level of trochanter. Just look at the level of trochanter here and here. This is normal, right? It comes down to be approximately onto the center of the femoral head, whereas it is at the level of the lip of the acetabulum. A foreshortened neck, coxa brevis, right? Acetabular abnormality like bicompartmental acetabulum, right? And hinged abduction. Now, the concept of hinged abduction is very important to understand. You can see a bump over here, right? Now, this bump is not allowing this femoral head to go inside completely. So whenever we abduct this hip, right, this abduction leads to levering out of the proximal femur, out of the acetabulum. So this is called hinged abduction, and it is marked by a bump on the lateral side and increased medial joint space. So whenever hinged abduction is present, it is a sure shot indicator that this will go into osteoarthritis and tendonitis managed. So Stuhlberg classification I was talking earlier, it gives us the correlation of outcome to osteoarthritis at the age of 40 years. So it depends upon sphericity, congruency, sphericity and congruency, and a easy Stuhlberg classification is of three types, right? Stage one is spherical congruity, stage two is aspherical congruity, and stage three is aspherical incongruity, out of which, as is logical, the aspherical incongruity is the worst, right? Now, since we are talking about Perthes disease, we must know the differential diagnosis, right? Meyer dysplasia, familial coxa plana, that is epiphyseal dysplasia, steroid-induced vascular inserts, sickle cell Gaucher's-induced vascular inserts, radiation-induced vascular inserts, they all form differential diagnosis of Perthes disease. Very important in our practice in North India is septic arthritis. This is not Perthes disease, right? This is bilateral septic arthritis, right? Another important case, right? This is retrospectively, I thought that this could be Myers dysplasia, although it presents as Perthes disease or an epiphyseal dysplasia. When it concludes the natural history, you can see that there is no subluxation, whereas Perthes disease at this stage should have subluxation, right? There is, coxa magna is to the minimum, right? So retrospectively, this could be Myers dysplasia. However, management at this stage, whether Perthes or Myers will be same. This was dealt with Chiari osteotomy and a GT distal transfer, right? So just keep in mind the differential diagnosis when you are seeing at the images. Thank you very much. Yeah.
I'm talking
about Manoj. Yeah, I concluded.
Any questions from the audience? Yeah. We'll take that.
Yeah, we have a couple of questions.
Get, Vikas Gupta to kind of get his presentation up. Go on, Dr. Manish.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So the first question is, what is the sequelae of Perthes? The sequelae of Perthes is coxa vara. So during containment of head by varus derotation osteotomy, we are decreasing the neck shaft angle more. How to justify it and how to calculate the osteotomy wedge base?
See, is the question for me?
Yes, go ahead, Alok.
Yeah. So, see, whenever we are doing a varus derotation osteotomy, we have to take care that the varus is never more than 15 to 20 degrees, right? So, if you want more varus to cover the head, then you have to add Estebolo procedure, like a shelf, like a Chiari, like a Salter osteotomy, anything, depending upon the age and presentation and according to your experience. But no more varus than 15 to 20 degrees. Second is that most of the times means 100% of the times, I use an open wedge osteotomy for producing varus. So that reduces the shortening which is inherent in a varus osteotomy.
Hello. Okay. I can ask you to stop sharing the screen.
Yeah,
so
sure.
That Vikas can say.
Kapil, I have a follow-up on that question.
Kapil, are you concerned about excess varus in a femoral varus osteotomy? What are your thoughts?
Yeah, Manoj, I rarely have done more than 20 degrees. Although I do an arthrogram intra-op before doing the osteotomy, and I will abduct the hip and where it sits nicely. That's the amount of wedge I take. But in my practice, I don't remember having taken out a wedge more than 20 degrees. Maybe sometimes a little less, but not more.
Manish, any questions?
Yeah. There are 3-4 questions. Now, for Perthes hip, whether the limb is painful or painless, and if it is painful limb, then what is the reason behind it? Usually, the Perthes has a painless limb.
PN Gupta, do you want to take that question?
Yeah. See, most of the time in Perthes, it is a painless hip. But sometimes, if there is a synovitis, there could be pain. That actually manifests with the loss of motion, painful loss of motion.
Plus the subchondral fracture.
Another question is, what is the reason for sectorial sign? Is it increased in internal rotation, in flexion or extension?
Alok?
I would like to comment upon both the questions. First of all, the pain is because not only of inflammatory response, as Dr. PN has rightly said, but also because of the adductor spasm. Right? And second is, once the disease progresses, there is extrusion of the epiphysis. Now, once the epiphysis has extruded, the concentration will be on the lateral side of the epiphysis, right? That will result in pain again. So pain can be there both in the initial stages as well as in the advanced stages of the Perthes disease. What was the second question?
Sectoral sign.
Yeah, sectoral sign. Now, what do you mean by sectoral sign? Sectoral sign is that depending on different degrees of flexion and extension, there will be difference of rotations. Now, we know that the central and anterior part is the most commonly involved part in Perthes disease, right? So, once this part is not articulating with the acetabulum, in that position, the rotation will be free. But when this part articulates with the acetabulum in that position, there will be restriction of the range of motion. Is that okay?
Manish? Any questions?
Yeah, there are 2 more questions. I think Dr. Manoj, Dr. Alok Singh is not very, voice is not very audible. So you can take the
question. Yeah, I will. Yeah.
So how to differentiate radiologically the stage one ischemia and stage three of reossification, since both look almost normal. Any tips?
I didn't hear the last bit of the question. Is this differentiate between?
Radiologically between the stage one of ischemia, he's talking about Perthes, and stage three of reossification. So they look almost the same. So you have any tips to differentiate between them?
I think radiologically stage one and stage three. Stage one is you don't have any signs of collapse. So it is purely a radiodense picture. It's actually quite difficult sometimes to actually pick up the diagnosis. Stage three, you would expect some amount of flattening. So there will be some loss of height for sure. Extrusion can be there because ossification starts from the lateral side. So you may have some lateral ossification. There would be secondary metaphyseal changes by that time in the in more severe cases. So these are the markers. Stage one and stage three, you should be able to differentiate, but stage three will have a lot more florid signs.
Yeah, can I
now, comment on that? One more question, sir. Yeah,
so,
sorry.
Yeah, go on. Yeah.
Yeah, can I comment on that? The question was the difference between stage two and stage three.
No, so stage one and three.
Stage two and stage three.
Stage one and stage three.
Stage one and stage three is very, it's
yeah.
very
so that's
easy.
Been answered, Alok. That's been answered. Manish.
Now, how to clinically find out hinged abduction without dynamic X-ray?
Say that again.
How to clinically find out hinged abduction without dynamic X-ray?
P.N. Gupta, do you want to take that? The diagnosis of hinged abduction. P.N., unmute.
Yeah.
Unmute, please.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, sir.
Yeah. So, diagnosis of a hinge abduction is basically a radiographic diagnosis. It's very, very difficult to actually have a clinical diagnosis of a hinge abduction. I would go only with radiography.
It can be further augmented by an orthogram. Orthogram is actually very good for hinge abduction.
So, can we get Vikas to load up his talk?
Yeah, Dr. Manoj, two more questions have come.
Please ask the questions. Let Vikas.
Yeah. How does epiphyseal perfusion scan play a role in treatment of Perthes disease?
Epiphyseal perfusion scan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anybody wants to take that?
Actually, epiphyseal perfusion scan is helpful for the diagnosis of Perthes disease. It will tell you about the amount of epiphysis that has been involved. It can tell you, it can improve upon Cattrall's classification, right? So it can tell you whether it is whole of epiphysis is involved or less than 50% is involved, which is not very easily seen on a plain radiograph. And that is why probably MRI or perfusion scans are now done in Perthes disease early in the age.
So prior to radiological changes becoming clear cut, it is useful to quantify the extent of involvement. Precisely quantify the extent of involvement because a lot of management is also dependent on the extent of involvement. Sometimes you may not get X-ray changes to confirm that it is more than 50%. So perfusion scanning is usually to categorically say that it is extent of involvement. So sometimes it takes a while for radiological signs to be clear so that you can classify them. Yeah, Manish?
Can I add?
Yeah. Manish, last question. What is the role of intraphyseal bisphosphonates?
I think Sanjay should take that question. He has some experience with bisphosphonates. Intraphyseal bisphosphonates, Sanjay?
In Perthes?
Yeah, I know you have a lot of experience with bisphosphonates.
I have never tried that in Perthes. I don't think I wouldn't know, really.
I think there is some experimental. There is no...
IV, yes. I have tried it and I found that it only prolonged the reabsorptive phase. And at the end of which, the collapse still happened.
I can't answer the effects of it. But I've heard Harry Kim from US using intralesional bisphosphonates, but it's experimental. I don't think any of us have clinical experience or it's indicated at the moment.
Yeah.
Yeah. If I can get the last two questions come up, if there are no more questions.
Okay. No, there are no questions. We can continue with the presentation.
Please.
Can you see this?
Yes.
Okay. So before I proceed, just to answer the question raised by Alok, the perfusion scan is being now used in some of the unstable slips to see the vascularity. Okay. So this is the last topic of this webinar, slip capital femoral epiphysis. And you all know it's the commonest adolescent problem, commonest adolescent hip problem. Yet, in spite of that, still there is no consensus. In fact, even the surgeons working in the same unit may not agree on the optimal management. So let us see what is the consensus at the end of this talk. And what Watson-Jones said in 1962 still holds true, that treatment of displacement of upper femoral epiphysis is not a very happy chapter in the history of orthopedic surgery. So coming to the decision making, how should we proceed is based on two factors, stability and the severity of the slip. So we'll discuss these cases one by one, stable slip, mild to moderate, stable, which is severe slip, and unstable slip. Now, what about the stability? A functional classification given by Loder way back in 1993, a child with stable slip can ambulate with or without crutches, whereas a child with unstable slip cannot ambulate even with crutches. So what is the importance? Why are we using this classification? Because a stable slip has a better prognosis with low, almost negligible AVM rate. An unstable slip has a poor prognosis with high AVM rate varying from 22% to 47% in different series. And in fact, one meta-analysis has showed that there is 9.4 times risk of AVM in unstable slip as compared to stable slip. So coming to another classification, a morphologic classification, that is the severity. How much is the slip angle, which is also known as Southwick angle and seen on a lateral view. That is called epiphyseal shaft angle. This is the angle formed by the axis of the femoral shaft and another line which is perpendicular to the epiphysis. So based on this angle, we can classify as a mild slip, angle less than 30 degree, a moderate slip, angle between 30 to 60 degree, and a severe slip, where a slip angle of more than 60 degree. So why are we concerned? A slip will determine the residual deformity once this is fixed. Okay? So a residual deformity, a severe residual deformity can lead to femoral acetabular impingement, which can have its own consequences like degenerative changes. So our treatment decision is based on the stability as well as severity. Now, coming to this case one, a 13-year-old boy, as you can see, an obese, a BMI of more than 35, he was limping for last 3 months. And remember, friends, that pain may not be there in the hip joint. So he was having more pain in the knee as compared to hip, outflowing gait on the left side, as is clearly seen. I'll run the video again. So you can see that's outflowing gait and the restriction of movement, especially flexion and internal rotation. And there was no endocrine pathology. And this typical sign, once you flex, the hip goes into obligatory external rotation, which is called Denham sign. Why this happens? Because actually the slip is a misnomer. It is not the epiphysis which slips. It is the metaphysis which goes into anterior superior. It goes into varus, it goes into extension, and it goes into external rotation. So when you flex the hip, it goes into external obligatory external rotation, which is called Denham sign. So actually it is not of the slip of the epiphysis, but actually the slip of the metaphysis. So how do you proceed? You get the bi-directional imaging, not the single X-ray view, because you have to compare. In a AP view, frontal view, you see the reduced physial height, epiphyseal height, and a positive Trithoven sign. And I hope you all know what is positive Trithoven sign, that this line, which is tangential to the femoral leg, superior femoral leg, does not transect the epiphysis. And definitely you want to know the slip angle, and by the lateral view, you get the Southwick angle, which is around 34 degrees. So it's a borderline between mild and moderate slip. Okay. Stable, mild and moderate slip. So what do you do? Now, there are four options. Leave it and observe. Hip spica, in situ pinning, or open reduction. I think there will be consensus on this, that in situ pinning remains the treatment of choice in this patient. So coming to the in situ pinning, I think this is the topic which I think our younger friends, postgraduates and citizens must know, the various issues related to this. So what is the goal? The goal is to prevent further slip progression, not to reduce whatever slip has taken place, so that to secure the proximal femoral epiphysis. Now, there are certain issues. I think some of which are controversial, and like what table, what should be a flexure table or radiolucent table, type of the implant, number of screws, and its placement. I think most of us will agree on most of these issues. Now coming to the type of table. Flexure table actually makes the sitting very easier. But remember, it should not be a forceful reduction, gentle, serendipitous reduction, the gentle positioning, and it allows good lateral view and better control. And that is my choice, to fix the slips in a flexure table. But having said this, some of us may be doing these slip fixation in a radiolucent table, in which it is easier and faster setup, especially for a bilateral slip. You have a better visualization of both the hips. Okay, so you need not move the C-arm. And in fact, one of the paper has shown that surgical time is less and less radio exposure. But the downside, actually a big downside, is the guide bar bends. As you flex and abduct the hip for the lateral view, it bends. So what about the pinning? I think with advancement in the last 20 years in metallurgy and better understanding of the biomechanics, we have all abandoned the smooth K-wires or threaded pins because these of the complications such as high rate of migration. However, they were very popular in 90s because of ease of insertion and removal. And the current recommendation and the treatment of choice is a cannulated, a single cannulated screw, 6.5 mm or larger. And what about the threads? It is always preferable to have a fully threaded or a long threaded. Remember, to choose a 32 mm, not the 16 mm, because of the higher biomechanical strength and to exert an epiphysodesis effect. And in fact, the thread should be reverse cutting for easier removal. Otherwise, the screw breaks like this. And this is something which I think we may have in future, the dynamic method of fixation, in which the threads are in the proximal part, which allows growth and remodeling. Probably in the cases where the slip has occurred in a younger age and you want to prevent the epiphysodesis effect and yet allow remodeling. So these, I think I have no experience about these, but these are the something which might have in future. Now regarding single screw or multiple screws. Now remember, it is not like a fracture neck femur where you will try to fix with this two or three screws. So a single screw inserted properly results in good outcome. The studies have shown that there's a 10% degree of 10 degree slippage in 20% of the cases. And two screws theoretically would give better torsional stiffness. There is no doubt. But is it justified? Increased torsional stiffness leading to increased complication rate, as shown by Blanco in an extensive study of 114 hips, that complication rate was 4.6% with one screw and 36% with three screws, especially the joint migration. So the current consensus is using a single cannulated screw applied in a center position, that is center of the epiphysis in both AP as well as lateral view, which should be the ideal, and avoid superior and the posterior placement, which will jeopardize the blood supply of the femoral head. Now regarding how much thread should engage in the epiphysis. Now it's something tricky, especially in a moderate slip, severe to moderate slip. And it has been reported that in a study by Carney, that there was 10 degree further slip in 40% of the cases in which thread less than 5 threads engaged the epiphysis. Whereas there was no further slippage when 5 or more threads engaged the epiphysis. So the goal should be to engage as many as at least more than 4 threads in the capital femoral epiphysis, maintaining a center position. And remember that to avoid joint penetration, the tip of the screw from the subchondral bone should be more than 4 millimeter on a lateral view and a 6 millimeter on a AP view. Though it sounds very simple, but actually at times becomes very difficult. Now coming to back to the case, the same case which I showed you. So slip on the left side, but we went for prophylactic fixation on the right side also. So this was done on a fracture table. Bilateral legs were extended, abducted, no forceful reduction. And this is one of the trick I think some of you might be using to actually find out the trajectory of the guide wire. You place the two guide wires, both in the AP and the lateral view. And where they cross actually marks the entry point of that guide wire. Though it may not be accurate in most of the cases, gives some idea actually where to start the entry point. So what you do is a semi-open method, basically just a small incision, not percutaneous, small incision, cut the facial artery, and you insert the guide wire, check in both the views, and you do the fixation. Use the appropriate screw. Now, remember, friends, they in a neck femur, the screw has to go anterior to posterior to anterior because of the anteversion. Whereas in a in situ pinning, in a slip capital femur epiphysis, it is usually anterior to posterior. So this is follow-up. The child is doing well and there are no abnormal radiological findings. Now, coming to a second case, a severe stable slip. Here, I think we may not agree. So, another boy, he presented in 2013. Again, a chronic slip. He was presented with an outgoing gait, a painful limb. And you can see the slip angle was somewhere around 70 degrees, okay? A high slip angle. Now, what do you do? In situ fixation, in situ with IT osteotomy, or a safe surgical dislocation. I think there will not be any consensus. But that we will see during our discussion. So, what about the in situ fixation? Or let us compare in situ fixation alone or with corrective osteotomy versus open adduction. So, in fixation in situ has its own advantages without any risk of avian, but it might result in retinal deformity, that is FAI. Whereas corrective osteotomy, either done immediately or at a later date, as well as modified done, has a theoretical risk of avian, varying from 12 to 26%. Let us see what the survey says. A similar survey done in 2018, published in JPO, a European survey, where 67% were in favor of in situ fixation with single screw, and they commented that they would go for some kind of reorientation osteotomy later on. Whereas American survey, POSNA, there was equal distribution for all the options, but more aggressive surgeons were in favor of safe surgical or modified done approach. Okay. So, in this case, 2013, I went for in situ fixation, though it was not a very ideal placement, center, but the epiphysis was fixed. And I followed this child, luckily, and 2016, there has been some femoral head changes, but he's doing well. And this is the last X-ray, September 2019, clinical radiologically, he is fine and he's asymptomatic at present, almost after 6 years. Now, in situ fixation is safer in short term. And I think there should be the choice for most of our senior residents who are doing these cases. Reproducible results, low complication rate, and it achieves its goal of slip progression. And some remodeling of the femoral head is expected, although may not be sufficient. So symptomatic patients can be managed later on by reorientation osteotomy or osteochondroplasty. Having said this, the paper by Kachinda showed a good outcome. That mean IOWA score was 89.6. After follow-up of 5 years. However, long-term follow-up has been poor, shown by these two papers, a follow-up of 41 years and a follow-up of 18 years, where 75% of severe slips had severe osteoarthritis, probably the radiography. So, why poor results? Question is, why poor results? Because a severe slip leads to altered morphology. There is altered neck shaft angle, which can lead to FAI with hip pain, decreased range of movement, and the condylar and labral damage. And higher rate of radiographic as well as poor functional result, that is too long term. In fact, three retrospective studies have shown that they were followed up from 31 to 41 years, that in a mild slip, radiography was seen in 60% and symptoms only in 7.1 to 10%. Whereas severe slip, radiographic osteoarthritis as well as symptoms. What about in situ fixation with intertrochanteric osteotomy? So some of us may say that intervene before irreversible joint damage occurs. So reorientation osteotomies have become popular, which can be classified either as temporal, maybe done along with in situ fixation, or later on when the child becomes asymptomatic or maybe some radiographic changes are there. And in terms of level, it could be subcapital, femoral neck, or intertrochanteric, which is nowadays popular than other two osteotomies. That is Southwick or Imhotep, which is triplanar, valgus, flexion, and internodation kind of osteotomy. And in fact, this study has shown when they compared similar number of children, 10 children with in situ fixation and 10 children with in situ along with osteotomy, there was no difference in functional score, that is Harris hip score. However, combined group had a better flexion and internal rotation, that is better range of movement. And when compared with long-term, they found that early outcomes may not be improved, better long-term effect, as shown by this study, that in 51 patients followed up for 24 years, 55% had good results. So the last option, safe surgical dislocation, that is modified done. I think modified done in terms of theoretical advantage corrects the deformity at the site of deformity, restores the normal anatomy of the slip, and thereby minimizes the changes due to FAI. But having said this, it is a technically demanding procedure, and AVN rate may be as high as 26%, those who are not doing it regularly. So now, this 12-year-old girl again had a severe slip of around about 60 degrees, and this is somewhere, I think, 217 when I was started doing this safe surgical, and this was managed by a safe surgical dislocation, a modified done. And this was the post-op x-ray when everything seemed normal. Now, if you look closely, one of the screw actually had been in this subchondral bone. So, which was, and CT scan again confirmed. So you have to be very particular. This can lead to chondrolysis, which was subsequently revised, and it was later removed after 2 years, and the girl is doing well. So coming to the last case, unstable acute slip. Now, unstable acute slip, though rare, they actually present like a fracture machine. Sudden onset of severe excruciating pain. Child is unable to ambulate, externally rotated limb, and the fracture, the x-ray mimics like a fracture machine, like a Salter is type 1. However, there is no history of injury. So unstable acute slip. So what to do? I think this is bit controversial. Should you fix it immediately, delayed, or modified done, or some kind of open reduction like anterior approach or PASH? So unstable slips are difficult to treat, high incidence of complications, and till date, still there is no consensus. And there are some of the debatable issues like timing of surgery, should be incidental reduction or should be gently reduced, decompress or no decompression. Should we evaluate epiphyseal hemodynamics and best treatment strategy? I'm not going to discuss all these issues, but what is not debatable is that there's a higher rate of osteonecrosis varying up to 50% in some of the series. And this article by Paula Crane has shown that younger age, longer duration of the slip, and a higher slip angle has a higher incidence. In fact, he has shown that 1 degree increase of slip increases 4% risk of osteonecrosis. And regarding the survey, in 2005, the POSNA, 84% were in favor of in-situ fixation, either one or two screws. Now see, after 13 years, because of the advances, the same survey, 30% would decide after incidental reduction, that is gentle serendipitous reduction, whether to go for in-situ or some kind of open reduction. Whereas 70% were evenly split between in-situ fixation with decompression, in-situ fixation with decompression, or with modified done, that is open surgical dislocation. So in fact, even after 13 years, still there is no consensus, but more and more surgeons are now going in favor of the modified done. So this was my case in which I did modified done, but unfortunately I can see there are some osteonecrotic changes in the capitular femoral epiphysis, although the child is doing well. So there are some other techniques which I think hold promise, like PASH, in which he described 64 children. And he described this approach through a lateral approach, capsulotomy, evacuate the hematoma, and gentle close reduction using index finger, and fixation with a smooth K-wire, remember, not with screws. And results were excellent, probably difficult to reproduce. After minimum follow-up 12 months, he reported good outcome and low rate of AVN. Okay. So this was my case in which I attempted PASH technique. Looks simple, but actually it was a lot of tricks, and I could able to reduce it and fix with three screws. And after 7 months, the child is doing well. And this is only my only case of PASH, so I cannot comment upon this long-term outcome. So to conclude, treatment of slip varies significantly depending on the surgeon's type of practice and years in practice and numbers treated per year, not on the available evidence. Okay, so don't go by what the literature or book says. You have to see your own experience. And in-situ fixation is still the preferred option for majority of mild to moderate slip. I think you should always be practiced by most of our younger orthopedic surgeons. In severe slips, decision to choose between in-situ fixation, osteotomy, or modified done is again based on the surgeon's experience. Okay? rather than available evidence, which I have just said. Okay. Surgical hip dislocation holds great promise, though it's a technically demanding with steep learning curve, and probably we need to practice it more. Okay. And the last line, with present day technique, AVN in the unstable slip will never be a never even. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas.
Manoj.
Yeah, Manish.
Dr. Manoj, can I have one question? Manoj?
Yeah.
Hello. Dr. Vikas, thank you for the nice presentation. Can you hear me? I'm audible?
Yes. Hello.
Yes. Dr. Vikas, most of the children who are presenting to our OPD with the unilateral SCFE, we are going to... Hello. Can you hear me, Vikas? Vikas, can you hear me?
You are audible, sir.
Yeah. Vikas, most of the children with S. Hello. Vikas, can you hear me?
Please go ahead.
Yeah. Dr. Vikas, most of the children who are coming to our OPD.
Yeah, Vikas, sir, you are also audible.
I cannot hear, Ravi.
Okay.
Hello. Just check it, sir.
Something wrong from your side, Vikas.
I can hear you.
Okay, Dr. Manish, is there any questions from the audience?
Yeah.
So, first question is,
Vikas sir, are we audible to you?
Someone else can ask Manoj, some questions.
Please, Manish.
Dr. Manoj, you have four questions, so you can take it.
Yeah.
So, how do you differentiate between slip capital femoral epiphyses and Delbert type 1 neck fracture femur?
Oh, sorry, children. The computer audio was off.
Because there's a question going on.
Dr. Vikas,
can I ask you that question, which is this come from the audience? How to differentiate between Delbert 1 and a slip? Kapil Gangwal.
Manoj, the way I differentiate between the two is that usually there is a little bit of a callus or a remodeling kind of a thing that you see on the superior lateral part of the neck in the SCFEs versus the Delberts. Also, Delbert 1 more common in the younger age group as compared to SCFEs, which are more common in the older age group. I think these are the two differentiating factors. So if in a 9-10 year old...
I think we lost his audio.
Okay.
So
in a 9-10 year
old... Manoj, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear everybody.
Dr. Manoj?
I can hear.
Yes.
Dr. Kapil, can you hear us?
Yeah. So my take is that in a 9-10 year old child, if I find a Delbert 1, I'll probably take it as an acute SCFE. That's my take on it. Even if I don't see a lot of remodeling. Yeah.
PM Gupta, please go ahead, add something.
Yeah. I go with the history, actually. If there is a history of severe trauma, you know, it takes a lot of trauma in a child to produce a Delbert 1.
I second that.
Or from height or road traffic accident, and then you have that type 1 separation of the epiphyses, then it is taken as a traumatic fracture. And if it is a minor injury like playing, skipping or jumping or anything of that sort, then it is taken as an acute slip.
To summarize, Manish, first is what the panelists have said is a history. Delbert 1 is a high energy injury. Age is a differentiator, and slips will show some chronic changes, as Kapil alluded to, sometimes callus and things like that.
Okay. Now, the next question is, when do you do prophylactic pinning of the opposite asymptomatic side?
Sanjay, do you want to answer that?
Well, the incidence of a slip on the opposite side can be as high as 40%. There are, you can offer it prophylactically to patients who seem to have a predisposition to SCFEs, like an obese kid, a hypogonadic kid, or even routinely to other children. But here in India, in our practice, practically speaking, parents become very suspicious. They start thinking, why is he wanting to pin the opposite side as well? So my policy here is, if a kid is from far away and I cannot follow him up regularly, I would certainly offer prophylactic pinning on the opposite side. And for patients who are local, and don't have such a all those features which come with the SCFE, then I would say wait and watch, and if at the first hint of a symptom, come back and we will pin it. This is what I normally do. Having said that, again, there was a doctor's child, I remember, I offered prophylactic pinning on the opposite side. He said, no, I'm a doctor, I'll monitor him. And he had a safe surgical dislocation on one side. And lo and behold, he came back with a severe slip in 8 or 9 months' time on the opposite side. And he had to have a safe surgical dislocation on the opposite side as well. So, yes, offer prophylactic pinning to all people and see who takes it and who accepts it. Because people here, they don't do it so easily.
Okay. Dr. Manoj, can I go for the next question?
Yeah, yeah.
How do you differentiate the early onset arthritis from chondrolysis?
Because you had an X-ray which showed a screw tip inside the joint.
Yeah.
So how do you differentiate chondrolysis from early arthritis?
Even a chondrolysis manifests quite late. At least after the follow-up of 6 months, a chondrolysis will show like a decrease in the joint space, and arthritis will late to develop. You don't expect arthritis to develop so early in a child who has a slip. So radiographic, the changes of arthritis are quite like the uniform decrease in joints or eccentric decrease in joint space, lipping, and these changes take a long time. Probably in the adulthood, a chondrolysis will manifest like a uniform decrease in the joint space with symptoms like stiffness and decreased range of movement.
Manish, any questions?
Yeah, Dr. Manoj, can I go for the next question?
Please.
When do you do only reduction and pinning, and when do you do done osteotomy?
P.N. Gupta, I think this can be open to a few panelists. P.N. Gupta, Ramani, yeah. And Sanjay.
Well,
can you repeat the question?
When do you do only reduction and pinning, and when do you do done osteotomy?
Okay.
All right. So in a unstable slip, if it is a mild slip, I would usually go in for a pinning. And if there is an incidental reduction while positioning on the table, I will go in for a pinning if that thing is able to go to a mild slip variety. However, if it is a moderate to severe slip, I would go in for a safe surgical dislocation and a capital femoral realignment. I have less experience in a stable slip. And in a stable slip, I would go in for an in situ pinning and a corrective subtrochanteric osteotomy. However, having said that, a lot of people would actually consider a modified done even in a stable slip, moderate to severe variety.
Ramani?
Yeah. So the question itself is a little controversial. Pinning with reduction. So whenever you're doing simple pinning, you don't reduce. That is one. You try not to reduce even in unstable slips. So unstable slips, like PN said, there is a lower threshold to resort to modified done in moderate and severe slips. Milder slips, pinning in situ or screw fixation in situ. In stable slips, I have had a experience with modified done. Manoj knows about it. So I generally try to avoid modified done, especially in private practice, in stable slips, because I mean, I have tried all kinds of techniques, all those techniques, but invariably there is a problem and you cannot explain to the family about the age. So as and when I can actually do a pinning in situ, I would do a pinning in situ and tackle the problem by an intertrochanteric osteotomy at a later date. So modified done, I'm moving away, doing modified duns in stable slips. I will probably resort to a modified, because ultimately you have to weigh two things. One is FA, femoroacetabular impingement, which is going to occur at a later date, and an AVN, which is going to relatively occur at an earlier date and higher incidence whenever you attempt it in a stable slips. So in a private practice, I would be you know, trying to keep that modified done as a last resort. In...
Manoj, can I add?
I think I asked Sanjay to kind of comment on it.
No, just want to add that most of the unstable slips are severe slips. Unstable slips are usually not mild slips, if you see the severity criteria. So I think some of the panelists are saying mild unstable slip they would like to do in situ pinning. Sounds very irrelevant.
Yeah, I take your point, Vikas. See, the thing is, what happens is I always do it in a fracture table. The idea is never to reduce the slip. So when you give a little bit of traction, sometimes that in about 60 to 70%, the slips slightly fall in place. You're not trying to do anything. You're not trying any reduction maneuver. So at that particular point of time, you are taking a call whether what is the situation on giving that traction, what is the situation, what is the slip angle like, and you can take a call at that
point. I fully agree. That was one of the options.
Vikas, it's an audience question. I think we need to answer rather than a cross discussion. It's Sanjay.
Basically, if the slip is mild, it is in situ pinning. If the slip is severe, I would do a done. But it is the moderate one where I have a problem. Earlier years, I would do a done. But now I would say that if there are enough years of growth remaining, then do an in situ pin for the moderate. This is the plan I usually follow. If there is an unstable slip and your MRI says that there is an AVN, then also I would think of doing a done with a view that some blood supply might get restored, but after counseling the family very carefully.
I think what all the panelists have tried to convey is that modified done and safe surgical dislocation in a slip context is a technically demanding procedure. There is a learning curve. So it's not something to be taken lightly. There are significant risks with it. So you may need to kind of weigh the pros and cons in what you are dealing with. It may be safer in your hands to pin and deal with the problem later. So that's something which everybody needs to bear in mind.
Okay. Dr. Vineet Arora, you had a question. Dr. Vineet, are you around?
I can't see him.
Okay, no problem. Then last question from the audience. Where do we stand today with cuneiform osteotomy?
Vikas, do you want to touch about cuneiform osteotomy?
That is subcapital osteotomy.
Yeah.
I think it has no role. The higher the osteotomy, the higher the incidence of AVN. So if you are planning to do the osteotomy, it has to be at the intertrochanteric level. And either at the time of fixation, or I would say the best would be, as PN is saying and he's been doing, is to go for osteotomy at a later date, preferably after 6 months or after a year, when you can see some kind of like some remodeling might have occurred, and you know actually know the pathoanatomy and how much is to be corrected. Cuneiform osteotomies or transcervical osteotomies are more theoretical, just to complete the list. Manoj, you have an experience.
I haven't got Kapil involved in the slip discussion. I'd like his view on what is view on modified done. Is he doing a lot of them, or are you holding back now?
Just for the acute slips, Manoj, and like Vikas said, that they are the most severe ones. Typically for the chronic stable ones, even if they are severe, I just pin them in situ. And the ones that I've had, they've remodeled quite a bit. I haven't had to do any subtrochanteric osteotomy for any one of those as of now. So that's my take on them.
Anish, any more questions?
No, questions are not there, but we have 5 minutes, so we can wrap it up.
Is there anything that...
So can I ask a question?
Sure, go on.
Yeah, so Vikas... I heard when you presented, you were talking about a possibility of putting one single screw in unstable slips. Wouldn't it be better to put two screws in unstable slips along with the decompression that you might plan along with it?
In situ fixation or open?
In situ. You said one or two screws. So I think it should always be two screws in unstable slips.
Frankly, Ramani, I have stopped using in situ fixation in unstable slip. Hello?
the Vikas's answer, okay. I don't know whether you heard, so that he does not
probably the modified that.
Like in situ fixation, if you see, even in a mild to moderate sleep, inserting a single screw per se is not an easy task. Those who have been doing it regularly. But putting a second screw above and over a single screw increases the rate of complication, especially joint penetration, and it might jeopardize the blood supply. So I think the same concept applies to the unstable sleep if you are going for in situ fixation in an unstable sleep. But having said this, I think unstable sleep is not a cakewalk. And whatever you do, there's still a high rate of AVN. And my treatment method has been evolving in unstable sleep, though they are not very common. So like few of the cases have gone for this modified done. And the last case, the PASH technique. I think that this PASH technique seems to be a much simpler version of modified done, especially on stable sleep. Go ahead.
I think we'll have Vikas, to pick up there because I think we are well short of this thing.
No, just one observation.
Yeah. I think we are.
So the point is, if you follow this particular regime of if you are in the center, on the X-ray, on the fluoroscopy, you make sure that the tip is at least 0.5 centimeters away from the surface.
Millimeter.
If you are away from the center, at least 1 centimeter. So if you follow that regime, the chances are that you probably would not. And moreover, at the end, I have a...
Ramni, if you follow these criteria, then thread purchase may not be there. It has to be 4 to 5 mm only.
I think we are. I thank all of you guys, panelists, all of you.
Thank you very much. It was a good presentation.
If I can ask Dr. Sharad Agarwal to kind of give his closing comments. We sat through the whole thing patiently, and I hope it was educative enough.
Thanks, Dr. Padma. It was really, really very interesting. And we really enjoyed, and it was a sort of a revision for me for all these subjects. Well, good evening, friends. Thanks you all for joining today's webinar, which was third in the series of webinars on pediatric orthopedics. It was a joint effort of Delhi Orthopedic Association and Pediatric Orthopedic Foundation. My thanks to Dr. Manoj Padman and his eminent faculty for presenting the webinar today on elective pediatric orthopedics. Excellent topics were chosen. We don't see these conditions in our practice very often, but we got to know enough about them so that at least we do not miss them in case a case presents to us. All in all, it was a useful and informative learning. My special thanks to Dr. Manish, Dr. Samshul Hoda, and Dr. Ashok Shyam for working really hard behind the doors to make these webinars of DOA a huge success. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And I thank the whole faculty and especially Dr. Ashok Shyam, Dr. Samshul Hoda, Dr. Ravi, for giving us this opportunity so that we can have a combined association of Delhi Orthopedic Association and Pediatric Orthopedic Foundation. So thank you, everyone. Good night and happy Eid to all of you.
Thank you very much. And happy Eid. And thanks a lot. Thank you. Good night.
Dr. Samshul, happy Eid to you. Dr. Samshul.
Yes, sir.
Happy Eid to you because Eid is tomorrow.
Happy Eid to everybody.
From all of us.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Happy Eid. And I'm ending the live stream, sir. Bye.